10, 9, ignition sequence.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
1-0 and lift off.
Mission complete, Houston. After serving the world for over 30 years, the space shuttle earned its place in history and has come to a final stop.
Our meeting today is dedicated to the traditional raising of the flags of all the countries partners to this project. And now I request the crews to come up and raise the flags. And I congratulate everybody who's arrived here. I'd like to wish a great success and successful termination of all the activities prior to the launch. I congratulate you on finishing the preparation work and on starting the final activities prior to launch. Good morning. Good morning. How are you all doing? Everything is great. Well, we all understand that the front crew and the backup crew both will be wearing the suits. The vehicle is all ready, so please take care and be very cautious regarding your movements. Don't rush.
Okay, sure.
One more. Thank you very much.
Рукава засучили, работаем. Это мы едим спустя рукава, а вот работаем засучили.
На меня, пожалуйста.
Обязательно.
Спасибо.
Is it all?
Геннадий Иванович.
Да.
Я здесь.
Геннадий, I'm here. Everything is done. The only thing that's left is some Velcro on the side.
They
look great. Remember when he was a backup, he has some trouble, but now it's all fine. Do you see my elbows are wrong? Should be the other side. We'll turn it around, don't worry.
Да, хорошо.
первое время составило 30 секунд, второе.
Да?
Да? Не будем, не будем. А? Нет. Не будем, не будем.
Не надо сейчас.
Не добавить, не
добавить. Эти твои цифры, которые...
Ребята, положить там, удобно. Так, удобно, да? Готов? Принято. Это подгруз, это команда 001. Второе время составило
57 минут. Секунду,
секунду,
секунду.
Второе время плавным регулятором сбрасываем давление 54.
54. 54.
54.
So now we're going to put on the boots. Attention, please. All right, thank you. We're gone. Attention, please.
Еще раз.
Once again.
Есть, да?
Сейчас.
Вот.
Вот. Отлично, отлично.
This is better. Just excellent.
Сейчас, одну секунду.
Да, для нас. Джон. Отлично.
Great.
Yeah, мы уже не можем.
We can't hold it anymore. And please careful with this regulator. Be careful not to scratch everything around you. Please sign.
Лена.
Ну ты раньше говори.
Там вроде опыт продается, баллончик.
Уже приступит к связи, может начинаем. Готовим.
Let's do comm check, shall we? He promised to change the lamps. The long-term lamps, because it's very annoying that they haven't yet been replaced. Everything is good, it's all nominal, no comment.
Спасибо.
let's remember those who died in the Second World War. I would like once again to wish you a happy, great holiday of May 9th, the end of the Second World War, and to wish all the best to our space, to our programs, to our cities, and to our countries. Thank you. Dear veterans, please allow me to wish you a happy May 9th, Victory Day. Dear veterans, dear inhabitants of the town of Baikonur, I would like to wish you a very happy day, Victory Day, on behalf of our backup crew and the prime crew. This is a holiday that made our people and our countries work very hard for several days, for several years. And I wish you all the very best.
Слово предоставляется настоятелю православного храма Святого.
Dear friends, I'd like to pass the floor to the priest of the Church of the Great Martyr. I'm going to use a gravitation indicator. Well, why not logic? There are lots of interesting experiments, including ecological experiments. Disaster areas and pollution, polluted areas.
Это 1802 год. Команда Крузенштерна.
Year 1802.
Боцман, да.
Крузенштерн's ship and expedition.
Джон Аллигейтор, штурман.
Джон Аллигейтор, steerman.
Everything's going well. And we're just counting down the days and ready to go.
This is true. It's not badminton. Once again, please. What else?
Игорь Семенович, ну как? В Рижке.
Игорь Смирович, come on.
Я не попаду.
По центру. I won't hit it. All right, the center.
Жо, еще раз. One more.
Let's do it again.
Да, друг, да.
Right at the center.
Стоп. Он не хочет.
Hang on, he doesn't want to.
Yes, we're on. Bam, can't miss that one.
Сразу видно работу в команде.
So we can see teamwork, that's it.
Скажите, как экология, геология слились для вас с космонавтикой?
How ecology and geology came down to mean human space flight to you?
Oh, there's a big connection with space and the ecology because it gives us an opportunity to see the Earth from further away and to see more of a big picture of what is happening on Earth. So it's a great opportunity to study Earth while we're in space.
This tree was planted by Yuri Gagarin, 1961. Ну,
например, у нас сейчас подготовился постер.
Наш say we just prepared a poster of our crew. And the theme is from the film Only the Elders Go to War. So we decided to make this film the topic of our poster.
Слоган не могем, а можем.
And we'll have a motto on this poster. Yes, we can.
Так, и мы что, помогаем вначале, да?
Нормально. So shall we assist? Do you know exactly what specific trees you're planting? The more the better. This tree was planted by Akaba.
Кто не пройдет и 30 лет, здесь будет такая же аллея вот.
So 30 years more, and you have a beautiful LA with these trees. Yeah, a spade like a weapon in my hands. Look at me, please. This tree was built, was planted by Gennady Padalka.
Немножко бы окучил.
I need to add some more soil and then water it.
Joe, would you give a couple of comments on what's going on for NASA TV?
Yeah, it's great to be part of this tradition. And when you walk amongst the trees that are here, it reminds us of all the history, the hard work, and the sacrifices that were made before us. And this tree planting represents our contribution today and for the future of the space program. It's a wonderful day out here.
К своему первому полету я готовился на Мир.
My very first flight, when I was being prepared for it, it was for the Mir station. And now this is the ISS with our partners, lots of trips, because we have training at NAS and at ESA.
American vehicle as compared to the Russian vehicle, it involves a lot of travel. Of course, the there's the language that makes things more difficult.
Конечно, проблемы с языком.
But I'm very fortunate to be flying with, of course, Gennady, a very experienced crew member, and with Sergey, who's done a fantastic job. So it's been a wonderful experience, and we are ready for the launch.
Я знаю, что для вас это первый полет.
I know it's your first flight. Any worries? Any concerns?
Может более и мобилизировать.
Well, on the one hand, yes, but on the other, I'm more concentrated, more focused.
Сидя в корабле перед стартом.
And our preparation is constant teamwork, constant communication and assistance to each other.
Good morning once again from NASA's Johnson Space Center. This is Mission Control Houston, a view inside the International Space Station Flight Control Room as a team of flight controllers watches over systems aboard the orbiting complex. The team today is led by Flight Director Edvan Seiss. He is serving as the lead for the team, overseeing this team throughout the daytime hours here in Houston, which is the essentially the midpoint of the crew's work day on orbit. Joining him is veteran astronaut Anna Fisher. She's handling the communications link between the Houston Flight Control Room, the team here in Mission Control, and the crew on board the International Space Station. The ISS is tracking around the Earth every 92 minutes at an altitude of about 250 statute miles, just about to move into an orbital sunset off the coast of Somalia, tracking southeasterly. We'll take it high above the northern coastline of the island of Madagascar and then out over the Indian Ocean, and then skirting along the western coast of New Zealand, then out across the Pacific into an orbital sunrise. The crew on board the International Space Station Expedition 31 is made up of Commander Oleg Kononenko. You see in the center of the picture. On the right in this view is European Space Agency astronaut André Kuipers from the Netherlands. And on the left is astronaut from the United States, Don Pettit. All three crew members have previous spaceflight experience, and they're now in their 141st day in space, 139 of those aboard the International Space Station on a long-duration mission, headed for a total of about 193 days before they return home on their scheduled date of Sunday, July 1st. On this Wednesday on board the station, the crew is focusing on a number of activities around the station. They're spread out in three different locations with Don Pettit working with some cargo transfer from the automated transfer vehicle number 3, the Eduardo Amaldi, supplied to the station program by the European Space Agency. He's also been working a great deal of time in a rack associated with the combustion experiment on board the station as well. He's been working with swapping out one of the fluid tanks associated with that piece of hardware that takes up almost an entire rack assembly inside the station's Destiny laboratory. Kuipers spent the day cleaning filters in three of the U.S. Connecting nodes, and also working with the Japanese Kibo laboratory, straightening it up ahead of the arrival later this summer of the third H2 transfer vehicle that's provided to the International Space Station program by the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency. And Commander Oleg Kononenko is working in the Russian segment of the station. He's been using a countermeasure system to take readings of any harmful contaminants in that Russian segment. The Zvezda module, which is, serves as the command and control function of the Russian segment of the station.
Riesigen Militärparade hat Russland den Sieg über Nazi-Deutschland vor 67 Jahren gefeiert. 14.000 Soldaten marschierten über den Roten Platz in Moskau. Panzer und Raketen demonstrierten militärische Stärke. Die traditionelle Parade nahm Russlands mächtiges Führungsduo ab. Wladimir Putin, der wieder Präsident und damit Oberbefehlshaber der Armee ist, und der gestern zum Regierungschef ernannte Dmitri Medvedev.
Am 9. Mai feiert Russland den Sieg der Sowjetunion über Nazi-Deutschland im Jahr 1945. Im Mittelpunkt steht nicht nur die Militärparade auf dem Roten Platz in Moskau, sondern es geht auch um die Helden vergangener Zeiten, um jene Veteranen, die im großen Vaterländischen Krieg, wie der Zweite Weltkrieg in Russland genannt wird, gegen die Nazis gekämpft haben.
Blumen für die Veteranen, so feiern die Russen den ganzen Tag lang ihre Helden, die für ihre Freiheit in den Krieg gegen die Nazis gezogen sind. Das Andenken an ihre Leistungen bei der Vaterlandsverteidigung soll hochgehalten werden. Das ist ein Tag der Freude, der Dankbarkeit. Ohne die Großväter, die für uns gekämpft haben, würde es uns wahrscheinlich gar nicht geben. Am Morgen gab es schon die große Siegesparade auf dem Roten Platz. Fast 14.000 Soldaten aus dem Heer, der Marine und der Luftwaffe marschierten auf. Der gerade wieder ins Amt des Präsidenten eingeführte Wladimir Putin sprach über die Schlüsselrolle der Sowjetunion bei der Beendigung des Zweiten Weltkriegs. Ich will heute nochmals betonen, die strikte Einhaltung der internationalen Normen, die Achtung von Staatssouveränität und das selbstständige Entscheiden jedes Volkes ist eine der bedingungslosen Garantien dafür, dass die Tragödie dieses Krieges sich nicht wiederholen wird. Für die Sicherheit in der Zukunft plant Russland eine umfangreiche Militärreform. Ältere Waffentechnik wird durch neuere ersetzt. Bis zu 580 Milliarden Euro sollen dafür bis zum Ende des Jahrzehnts ausgegeben werden. Auch das Arsenal der Interkontinentalraketen mit Nuklearsprengköpfen soll erneuert und erweitert werden. Russland will sich militärisch wieder stärken.
Zu dem geplanten Al-Qaida-Anschlag auf einen Passagierflug in die USA sind neue Einzelheiten bekannt geworden. Medienberichten zufolge war der vermeintliche Selbstmordattentäter ein Doppelagent, beauftragt vom saudi-arabischen Geheimdienst und der CIA. Dem Mann sei es gelungen, den Jemen mit der Bombe zu verlassen und den Sprengsatz den Behörden zu übergeben. Seine Informationen hätten die USA zu dem Luftangriff im Jemen veranlasst, bei dem am Sonntag der Al-Qaida-Anführer Kuso getötet wurde.
Die Al-Qaida im Jemen hat offenbar auf den falschen Mann gesetzt. Der jüngste Anschlagsplan wurde nach Medienberichten durch einen CIA-Informanten vereitelt. Der Mann habe sich für einen Selbstmordanschlag angeboten und dann alles verraten. Gestern war bekannt geworden, dass Al-Qaida einen Anschlag auf ein Passagierflugzeug geplant hatte. Dabei sollte ein Sprengsatz zum Einsatz kommen, der durch Metalldetektoren am Flughafen nicht erkannt werden kann.
In Indonesien wird ein russisches Passagierflugzeug mit 46 Menschen an Mord vermisst. Das hochmoderne Flugzeug vom Typ Superjet 100 sei bei einem Demonstrationsflug nahe der Hauptstadt Jakarta vom Bildschirm verschwunden. Auch gäbe es keinen Funkkontakt mehr, bestätigten örtliche Behörden. Der Jet ist das erste Passagierflugzeug, das in Russland seit dem Zerfall der Sowjetunion entwickelt wurde. Bislang hatten Triebwerksprobleme die Auslieferung verzögert.
44 passengers has gone missing during a demonstration flight over Indonesia. A government spokesperson says that the plane was meant to land in Jakarta, and the aircraft is one of Russia's newest civilian airliners. Phil Black joins me now live from Moscow for an update. And Phil, any more details on this missing flight?
Not a great deal, Christy, I am afraid. This aircraft that you mentioned, it is a new passenger aircraft, a Sukhoi Superjet 100. Most of the details that we have are coming from Indonesian and Russian media reports. And as you say, it was on a demonstration flight out of Jakarta's Halim Airport, about 44 people on board. It was only supposed to be in the air 30 minutes, but it went off radar and there has been no radio contact and it has not returned to that airport. We understand it conducted a number of two other demonstration flights that day, and in fact it is on a demonstration tour of the region trying to drum up business. This is a new jet, a new passenger aircraft. It seats about 100 people or so, and it has been considered a new hope for Russia's civil aviation industry. It is designed and assembled here, but it is also very much an international project in cooperation with an Italian company, a French company, Boeing, the US company was a consultant, and various parts and systems have been made around the world, and delivery to early customers in Russia and overseas was due to start this year. This is obviously not good publicity for a new project like this. The key question, of course, what happened? Well, first they have to find it, or what's left of it, and the Indonesian authorities are still looking, Christy.
Can you tell us more about the safety record of this new civilian airline, Sukhoi, and what is the general safety record for Russian civilian planes?
Well, recent or new Russian civilian aircraft, such as this one, have relatively good, strong safety records. But looking back, and Russia in particular, its airspace is considered to be among, if not the most dangerous in the world. But that's largely because of much older Soviet-era aircraft that are still being flown. In this case, this was a brand new plane, the latest technology. In consultation with the most advanced producers of aviation systems and so forth around the world. And there was a great deal of hope, a great deal of optimism surrounding this project. And that, obviously, is going to take a bit of a dent now, Christy.
All right, Phil Black, live in this story, ever developing for us. Thank you very much for that, Phil.
Branche bei einem Demonstrationsflug in Indonesien ist ein hochmodernes Passagierflugzeug mit mindestens 40 Menschen an Bord verschollen. Experten gehen davon aus, dass die Maschine abgestürzt ist. Das Flugzeug vom Typ Superjet 100, hier Archivbilder, war von Jakarta aus zu einem Testflug gestartet. Nach Angaben der Behörden brach während des Demonstrationsfluges plötzlich die Funkverbindung ab und die Maschine verschwand vom Radar. Rettungskräfte sollen jetzt nach dem verschwundenen Flugzeug suchen.
The Russian jet has disappeared during a flight in Indonesia. 37 people on board. Phil Black joins me now live from Moscow. Phil, what have you been hearing about this?
Michael, the details are still quite few, I'm afraid, but we are told that this aircraft has gone missing while on a demonstration flight out of Jakarta. It was only supposed to be in the air for around 30 minutes or so, but it dropped off the radar, has not responded to radio contact, and did not return to the airport. It had already conducted two demonstration flights from the same airport that day, and it is actually in the region on something of a publicity roadshow tour, the Sukhoi airline company calls it, to try and drum up business, aircraft sales, because this is still a relatively new model of aircraft. It's a commercial airline, seats 98 people. It has been described as a new hope for Russia's civil aviation industry. It is designed and assembled here, but very much in international projects with partners in Italian and French companies as well. And Boeing, the US company, was a consultant here, while many of the systems and parts have been constructed around the world. It is being flown already by an Armenian airline, by Aeroflot, the Russian airline, and the airline was hoping to start delivering on some of its early sales orders internationally this year as well. But so far, no comment from Sukhoi, the airline manufacturer itself, as yet. It is a national holiday here in Russia. This certainly will have come as something of a surprise, and certainly not good news for the company as it tries to drum up publicity for this new model aircraft, Mike.
Yeah, as you say, it is a new aircraft, but I suppose there's not much of a safety record to know about. But in general, Russian planes, what is their record?
Well, Russian airspace is notoriously dangerous, particularly for passenger aircraft, largely because of smaller regional airlines that still continue to fly very old Soviet-era aircraft. And there are acknowledged problems where the government says that maintenance, pilot training, in some cases even pilot drunkenness, is a widespread issue among much of those smaller airlines. In this case, as you said, and as we've said, it is a new model of aircraft. It is currently increasingly receiving certification to fly around the world. Sukhoi, the manufacturer, is traditionally mostly a military jet aircraft manufacturer. It also makes smaller commercial aircraft as well, but this new aircraft is its main ongoing project, its real hope. It had a lot invested in this, and it was certainly feeling quite optimistic about the level of sales that it could do, particularly in that region, Michael.
All right, thanks for the update, Phil. Phil back there in Moscow.
Ralf, gibt es irgendwelche Anzeichen, was mit der Maschine passiert sein könnte?
Es ist sehr, sehr interessant, wenn wir uns einmal anschauen, was auf dem Radarbild zu sehen war. Das heißt, die Informationen besagen, das Flugzeug ist auf einen Berg zugeflogen. Der Berg war ungefähr 2200 Meter hoch. Das Flugzeug hat kurz vor dem, ja, wir müssen ja von einem Unfall fast schon ausgehen, auch wenn man die Trümmer nicht gefunden hat. Also kurz davor hat das Flugzeug eine Höhe von ungefähr 1800 Metern gehabt. Also das heißt, es war unterhalb der Bergspitze und drehte eine Kurve um den Berg rum. Es war ein Demonstrationsflug. Man kann also davon ausgehen, dass ja, der Hersteller sein Flugzeug demonstrieren wollte, es sehr leistungsfähig präsentieren wollte. Wo kann man das anders machen als bei einem nahen Berg? Das kann eindrucksvoll sein, ein Schauspiel. Jetzt gibt es schon verschiedene Fälle in der Vergangenheit, wo solche Demonstrationsflüge dazu verleitet haben, ein bisschen zu viel zu riskieren. Eins ist ganz klar, Flugzeuge sollten normalerweise höher fliegen, damit man Reserven hat, wenn irgendwas passiert. Dann ist die Flughöhe wichtig, um einfach reagieren zu können. Wenn man dicht über den Boden fliegt, dann kann so etwas wie ein Zwischenfall, ein Systemausfall die Crew überraschen. Es kann aber auch gewesen sein, dass die Piloten vielleicht mehr auch sich haben ablenken lassen vom Berg, von der ganzen Situation. Das wissen wir jetzt nicht. Es ist auf jeden Fall davon auszugehen, dass ein gewisses Mitrisiko schon auf Seiten der Piloten ist, weil wer fliegt so tief, der muss auch einen Teil des Risikos nochmal tragen.
Vielen Dank für diese Einschätzung an unseren Luftfahrtexperten Ralf Benkö.
Bei einem Schauflug ist ein nagelneues russisches Passagierflugzeug mit 50 Menschen an Bord vom Radar verschwunden. 21 Minuten nach dem Start im indonesischen Jakarta fehlte von der Maschine vom Typ Sukhoi Superjet 100 plötzlich jede Spur. Dunkelheit und schlechtes Wetter erschweren die Suche. Der Superjet war auf Werbetour in Asien, denn die Maschine ist der erste russische Eigenbau seit Ende der Sowjetunion und soll Airbus und Boeing Konkurrenz machen.
Search and rescue officials have told us that they've dispatched a team to the area where it's thought the plane went missing now almost 6 hours ago. What we understand, what Indonesian officials have been telling us, is that the Sukhoi Jet 100 took off at about 2 o'clock, 2:20 local time. It was meant to make a very short trip, a demonstration flight basically, and on board we understand some 46 people, amongst them representatives of Indonesian Airlines and some journalists. Basically, this was a flight to show off the aircraft to people who might end up buying it. It was meant to just take a quick circular route and come back in about half an hour. The last point of contact was at around 2:50 local time when pilots requested to make a descent from 10,000 feet to 6,000 feet. As we understand, that was the normal procedure for any landing operation that they would have been taking. But that was the last point of contact. Officials have yet to make any contact with the plane. As I say, search and rescue teams are on the ground. They're headed out there right now. They're trying to make their way through what is pretty rugged and rough terrain. They're doing it on foot because helicopters that were sent there, as we understand, had to be turned back because of bad weather. At least one official is saying that.
Karishma Vaswani in Jakarta.
Ein russischer Passagierjet mit mehr als 40 Menschen an Bord verschollen und mit größter Wahrscheinlichkeit abgestürzt. Die hochmoderne Maschine vom Typ Sukhoi Superjet 100, hier ein baugleiches Flugzeug, war auf einem Vorführungsflug mit Vertretern indonesischer Fluggesellschaften an Bord. In der Gegend des 2200 Meter hohen Vulkans Salak, nahe der Hauptstadt Jakarta, verschwand der Jet vom Radarschirm. Bislang fehlt von ihm jede Spur. Zuvor hatte die Besatzung darum gebeten, die Flughöhe verringern zu dürfen. Der Superjet 100 ist das erste Passagierflugzeug, das in Russland seit dem Zerfall der Sowjetunion entwickelt wurde.
Gewaltige Eisplatte in der Antarktis. Bisher schien ihr der Klimawandel nichts auszumachen. Doch nun haben deutsche Forscher herausgefunden, dass ein gewaltiger Eisrutsch drohen könnte. Bislang ist das Filchner-Ronne-Schelfeis mit 470.000 Quadratkilometern die zweitgrößte permanente Eisfläche der Antarktis. Da warme Wassermassen dem Eis aber immer mehr zusetzen, könnte es nach Angaben der Forscher noch in diesem Jahrhundert komplett schmelzen. Durch nachrutschendes Eis würde dann der Meeresspiegel ansteigen.
Herzlich willkommen bei Nano. Es ist ein düsterer Blick auf unseren Planeten Erde. Mehr Naturkatastrophen, Umweltzerstörungen, geringeres Wirtschaftswachstum und Armut. Mit seinem Bericht 2052 zeichnet der Club of Rome ein dramatisches Zukunftsbild. Die Denkfabrik internationaler Experten aus Kultur, Wirtschaft und Politik rüttelte bereits vor 40 Jahren unsere westliche Welt auf. Mitten im Wirtschaftsboom warnte der Club 1972 vor den Grenzen des Wachstums und vor Umweltverschmutzung. Wirklich hören wollten die Prognose damals wie heute die wenigsten. Sie seien hysterisch, so einige Kritiker. Doch ob alles hundertprozentig zutrifft oder nicht, der Bericht 2052 wird ernst genommen.
Tornados rund um den Erdball, extreme Dürre, Hunger und immer wieder Wetterkapriolen. Der Klimawandel wird sich verstärken und spätestens in der Mitte des Jahrhunderts für soziale Unruhen und Leid sorgen. Nichts ist dann mehr, wie es mal war. Zu diesem Schluss kommt der neueste Report des Club of Rome mit dem schlichten Titel 2052. Was jetzt im Rahmen einer Konferenz in Rotterdam vom Autoren dieses Werkes präsentiert wurde, klingt mehr als pessimistisch.
Die Hauptnachricht von 2052 ist, mit der Menschheit wird es bergab gehen. Es wird keine sanfte Landung geben, sondern wir werden über das Ziel hinausschießen und auf einen Kollaps zusteuern.
Denn in den nächsten Jahren werden Umweltzerstörung und Ressourcenverbrauch zunehmen. Vielleicht stärker noch, als es der Vorgängerbericht Die Grenzen des Wachstums 1972 prophezeit hatte. Bereits vor 40 Jahren warnte Autor Dennis Meadows erstmals vor der Endlichkeit der Ressourcen und vor Umweltverschmutzung. Dafür wurde der Club of Rome mit Ehren überschüttet und der Report wurde zur Bibel der Umweltbewegung. Doch der Bestseller führte auch zu einem Glaubenskrieg. Und insbesondere in den USA sieht man in konservativen Wirtschaftskreisen alles ganz anders. Was ist in den letzten 40 Jahren passiert, also vom ersten bis zum heutigen Bericht? Die Weltbevölkerung ist rasant gestiegen und trotzdem leben die Menschen immer länger, werden reicher und leben gesünder. Folgt man dem neuesten Bericht des Club of Rome, dürfte sich das aber insbesondere in den USA bis 2052 ändern. Denn der neue Report sieht die Supermacht eindeutig auf der Verliererstraße. China und die Schwellenländer werden dann die Nase vorn haben. Trotz allem Pessimismus hinterlässt 2052 aber auch einen Hoffnungsschimmer.
Die globale Population wird ihren Höhepunkt mit 8 Milliarden Menschen 2040 erreichen. Das ist früher und auf einem niedrigeren Level, als die meisten erwartet haben. Der Grund dafür ist, dass sich die Familiensituationen in der armen und reichen Welt angleichen.
Denn die Menschen leben dann zunehmend in wachsenden Megacities und Frauen haben aufgrund ihrer höheren Bildung weniger Kinder. Weniger Bevölkerung bedeutet am Ende weniger Ressourcenverbrauch und weniger Umweltverschmutzung. Doch die Klimakatastrophe könnte dann schon eine Eigendynamik entwickelt haben und nicht mehr zu stoppen sein.
Mitglied des Club of Rome, aber auch sanfter Kritiker des neuen Reports ist der Wirtschaftswissenschaftler Uwe Schneidewind von der Universität Wuppertal. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir mit ihm sprechen dürfen. Guten Abend, Herr Schneidewind.
Guten Abend.
Einige Kritiker halten ja die Berichte des Club of Rome für Schwarzmalerei. Bleiben wir noch mal bei dem ersten Bericht von 1972. Was ist denn nun eingetroffen und was nicht?
Der Bericht von 1972, der hatte ja schon im Titel eine ganz zentrale Botschaft, eben die Grenzen des Wachstums. Das heißt, die Erkenntnis, dass vermutlich die natürlichen, die ökologischen Grenzen uns Grenzen auch für das ökonomische Wachstum setzen. Und diese Erkenntnis, die hat weiterhin volle Gültigkeit und hat sich über die letzten 40 Jahre auch gezeigt. Das, was im Bericht damals nicht richtig angedacht war, das deutlich zu machen an der Verknappung von Rohstoffen. Denn dort hat der Bericht es einfach falsch eingeschätzt, dass die Verknappung von Rohstoffen auch zu sehr intensiven ökonomischen Anpassungsreaktionen führt. Rohstoffe werden teurer, dadurch ist auch Anreiz da, mehr zu sparen, neue Vorkommen zu entdecken. Und das hat dann oft zu der falschen auch Diskreditierung des Berichtes geführt. Denn die Grundbotschaft Grenzen des Wachstums war absolut richtig. Man hätte es eben nicht an Rohstoffen verdeutlichen sollen. Und das korrigiert der neue Bericht in einer sehr schönen Form.
Wir haben es eben gesehen, die US-Amerikaner sehen das Ganze viel positiver. Sie sagen, wir wären gesünder, wir wären reicher geworden. Was bedeuten denn nun die neuen Prognosen für uns Industrienationen?
glaube, das ist eben ganz wichtig, dass der Bericht deutlich macht, dass es ein so weiter wie bisher nicht geben kann und dass es geradezu fatal ist, die Entwicklungsmuster der letzten 40 Jahre einfach zu verlängern, weil das war ein Wohlstand auch auf Pump der Natur. Und das macht der Bericht eben sehr deutlich, wenn wir weitermachen wie bisher mit unserer ökonomischen Entwicklung, dann werden wir viele dieser ökologischen Katastrophen zu vergegenwärtigen haben, wie sie eben auch in dem Film angesprochen waren und in dem Bericht ja auch sehr intensiv dargelegt werden.
Unter unserem hohen Lebensstandard leiden ja vor allem auch die anderen Länder, die Schwellenländer. Welche Länder haben denn in Zukunft am meisten zu leiden?
Ja, das ist ja etwas das Tragische, dass die Länder, die letztlich am wenigsten dafür können, dass wir die Probleme haben, am stärksten mit den Folgen zu tun haben. Wir Industrieländer, die wir ja verantwortlich sind für die meisten der CO2-Emissionen der letzten Jahrzehnte, wir werden uns vermutlich relativ gut anpassen können an den Klimawandel. Aber die armen Länder, die kaum dazu beigetragen haben, die werden eben viele der dramatischen Folgen, die wir gesehen haben, mit denen werden sie zu kämpfen haben. Diese gleichleistende Ungerechtigkeit, das ist natürlich auch Sprengstoff für die künftige globale Entwicklung.
Genau, arm bleibt arm, heißt es in Ihrem Report. Und es ist Sprengstoff, wie Sie sagen. Wie groß ist denn die Gefahr einer möglichen sozialen Revolte?
Es gibt sicher einmal die Gefahr auf einer globalen Ebene. Denn Sie können sich das vorstellen, dass Länder, die die Folgen ertragen müssen von ökonomischer Entwicklung in den Industrieländern, ohne selber was davon gehabt zu haben, dass das Tendenzen zur Radikalisierung weiter verstärkt. Also da steckt ein globaler Sprengstoff drin. Aber wir haben durchaus auch eine Gefahr für soziale Revolten zwischen den Generationen. Denn es sind natürlich die jungen Menschen heute und deren Kinder und Enkelkinder, die Folgen dann ertragen und auch ausbaden müssen, die ihre Väter und Großväter verursacht haben. Und da steckt dann auch in den Industrieländern selber das Gefahr von sozialem Aufbegehren zwischen den Generationen. Aber da kann natürlich auch eine Chance drin liegen.
Genau, das wollte ich gerade sagen. Es hat ja vielleicht auch was Positives, dass die Jüngeren vielleicht schon umdenken oder schon umgedacht haben.
Ja, also ich glaube, da liegt eine große Hoffnung drin, dass eben die junge Generation noch deutlicher auch von der Politik und von den Entscheidungsträgern heute einfordert, das ist diese Welt, die ihr uns überlasst. Und wir wollen eine Welt, die auch ökologisch noch tragfähig ist und gleichzeitig eine globale Gerechtigkeit erzeugt. Und darum müsst ihr heute anfangen, umzusteuern, um nicht zu verantworten, dass ihr eure eigenen Kinder und dann Enkelkinder mit einer solchen Welt, die kaum noch zu retten ist und so aussieht, wie sie vielleicht der Report gerade schildert, hinterlasst.
Kurze letzte Frage. Die wissenschaftlichen Methoden sind jetzt natürlich verfeinert worden innerhalb der letzten 40 Jahre. Wenn auch trotzdem nicht alle Prognosen zutreffen werden, welche große Bedeutung hat trotzdem der Bericht?
Also der Bericht ist einfach wichtig, weil er ein Weckruf ist. Ein Weckruf gerade an diejenigen und auch die Länder, die glauben, es kann weitergehen wie bisher. Und ich habe daher den Eindruck, aus dem Bericht ist ein ganz wichtiges Signal, zum Beispiel auch in Richtung USA.
Also wir müssen selbst was tun, damit die Prognose nicht ganz so düster ist. Herr Schneidewind, vielen Dank fürs Gespräch.
Der große Preis mit Wim.
So liebten ihn seine Zuschauer. Wim Tölke als ZDF-Quizmaster zur besten Sendezeit.
Das tut so gut. Ich gehe direkt zurück und komme nochmal. Herrlich.
Mehr als 30 Jahre lang zählte er zu den beliebtesten Moderatoren im deutschen Fernsehen. Und dieses Jahr wäre Tölke 85 geworden.
Guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren.
Anfang der 60er Jahre moderiert er die ZDF-Heute-Nachrichten, ist dann einer der Mitbegründer des aktuellen Sportstudios. Die berühmte Titelmelodie wird damals noch live eingespielt von Max Gregers Big Band.
Was war das, Max?
Ja, das ist unsere neue Erkennungsmelodie für das aktuelle Sportstudio.
Schon damals Tölkes Markenzeichen, seine ruhige und besonnene Art. Nichts kann Georg Heinrich Wilhelm Tölke, wie er eigentlich heißt, aus der Fassung bringen. Allenfalls renitente Pferde, wie das von Dressurstar Josef Neckermann 1968.
Ich habe immer das Bewusstsein gehabt, ich verkaufe nicht mich, sondern ich verkaufe Sendungen. Mein Ziel war es immer, dass die Sendung möglichst gut dasteht. Und selbst wird man sowieso im Laufe der Zeit berühmt, bekannt und auch beliebt.
Tölkes richtig großer Durchbruch kommt 1970.
glaube, das erste große Ding war dieses 3x9 Quiz-Sendung, die damals sagenhafte 25 Millionen Zuschauer geholt hat. Das sind natürlich Werte, die heute keiner mehr erreicht.
Ja, das ist also die Geburtsminute von 3x9. Und ich wurde in den letzten Tagen immer wieder gefragt, was macht ihr denn eigentlich da? Und habe ich gesagt, also passt auf, alles ist neu, alles ist anders, ihr werdet nichts mehr wiedererkennen.
Die Sendung spielt Geld ein für den guten Zweck, die Aktion Sorgenkind. Sie ist der Vorläufer für Tölkes nächsten Straßenfeger, der große Preis.
Guten Abend hier im Studio in Berlin, guten Abend auch daheim und herzlich willkommen zum großen Preis.
Als Tölke die Sendung angeboten wird, ist ein ähnliches Format bereits im Schweizer Fernsehen zu sehen.
Ich bin einmal in die Schweiz geflogen mit meinen Kollegen hier, Regisseur, Redakteur. Und wir fanden das ganz lustig, aber es war nur eine halbe Stunde lang. Wir sollten aber eine große Abendshow daraus machen, haben deshalb also ordentlich ändern müssen. Und wir waren keineswegs sicher, dass wir was Gutes machten, dass jedenfalls nicht, dass wir was Dauerhaftes machten. Ich hatte das Gefühl, diese Sendung und sechs andere und dann ist der große Preis beendet.
Doch es kommt ganz anders. Insgesamt 18 Jahre lang wird Tölke die Rateshow moderieren. Dank seiner Körperfülle bekommt er den Spitznamen Big Wim.
Ich weiß nur eins. Ich habe mal gesagt, Kinder, ich will jetzt mal 15 Kilo abnehmen. Da haben die gesagt, hör mal, wir haben Big Wim engagiert und nicht Little Joe.
Wim Tölke war immer der, der mit einem gewissen Anspruch an die Sachen ranging und sich am Ende dann duelliert hat mit Menschen, die dann sehr genau wussten, an welchem Tag jetzt Elvis vielleicht Magen-Darm-Verstimmung hatte oder wann nicht.
Das wissen ja unsere Zuschauer schon, das Geld können die Kandidaten gewinnen, aber daheim kann man so richtig mitraten.
Wenn Wim Tölke ein Kuvert aufgemacht hat und eine Frage gestellt hat, dann hätte nie ein Mensch zu Hause daran gedacht, die Frage könnte schlecht sein oder irgendwas könnte mit der Antwort nicht stimmen. Er war damals, zu seiner Zeit, als er die Fragen gestellt hat, einfach kompetent und glaubwürdig.
Ich habe ein Schnellgedächtnis. Ich kann unheimlich viel behalten. Ich habe die erste Runde in den letzten Jahren schon allein als Training für mein eigenes Gehirn und aus Spaß ohnehin auswendig vorgetragen. Hat auch niemanden, der mir irgendeinen Zettel oder einen Pappkarton hinhielt. Das war so mein persönlicher Sport, denn wenn die erste Runde vorüber war und ich hatte drei völlig unterschiedliche Themen mit was weiß ich, sieben Jahreszahlen und vielen Fremdwörtern gut über die Bühne gebracht, dann fühlte ich mich persönlich eigentlich ganz wohl.
219 Mal moderiert er den großen Preis für das ZDF. Doch 1992 ist Schluss mit Wim, Wum und Wendelin.
Wir drei haben so gut zusammengepasst. Ja.
Unzertrennlich wie die Muskeltiere.
Drei Musketiere, Wendelin.
Sag ich doch, Wim, Wum und Wendelin.
Und jetzt willst du uns nicht mehr sehen.
Aber wir sehen uns doch heute Abend nach der Sendung noch.
Wir werden Wim nie vergessen.
Bis 1994 ist Tölke weiter im Programm zu sehen.
Liebe Fernsehzuschauer, herzlich willkommen zu einer weiteren Folge der Sendereihe Klassentreffen.
In der beliebten Reihe bringt er Promis mit ihren früheren Schulfreunden zusammen.
Darf ich mal zunächst hier für unser weiteres Gespräch ein paar Dinge klären?
Ja.
Sind Sie lieber Frau Minister oder Frau Ministerin?
Ich bin lieber Frau Merkel.
Ende 1995 erliegt Wim Tölke mit nur 68 Jahren einem Herzleiden.
Ich habe Wim Tölke als jemanden in Erinnerung, der sehr klug war und ein auch melancholischer Mensch. Das war keiner, der jetzt so als Spaßgranate durchs Fernsehen wanderte. Und das war auch gut so. Das war genau seine Qualität.
Und damit bleibt er auch in Erinnerung. Bei Generationen begeisterter Fernsehzuschauer.
Seit nunmehr 60 Jahren tut sie das und verkörpert dabei Glanz und Traditionen, auf die Großbritannien zu Recht stolz ist. In der Thronrede trägt sie das Programm ihrer Regierung vor, mit unbewegter Miene, auch das wie immer. Denn was die Queen persönlich darüber denkt, das behält sie natürlich für sich.
Ungewohnten Gefühlsausbrüche, dafür aber überaus ungewohnte Anblicke gab es diese Woche in Großbritannien. Pünktlich zum 60. Geburtstag der BBC hat sich seine königliche Hoheit Prinz Charles höchstpersönlich als Wetterfrosch versucht. Ein Volltreffer. Leonie von Sachsen-Weimar zeigt's Ihnen.
Schiedwetter in Schottland. Kein Problem für ohnehin regenerprobte Royals wie Camilla und Charles. Passenderweise besucht das Paar das Wetterstudio des BBC in Glasgow. Wurde auch Zeit, dass endlich jemand von ganz oben diesem Wetter den Garaus macht. Denn nach einem kurzen Kennenlernen mit dem Wetterknöpfchen geht His Royal Highness als Wetterfrosch auf Sendung.
Und over to now, Your Highness.
This afternoon it'll be cold, wet and windy across most of Scotland.
We're under the influence of low pressure, and this weather front pushing northwards is bringing cloud and outbreaks of rain.
Trotz weniger erfreulicher Vorhersagen beeindruckt Prinz Charles mit seinem professionellen Auftritt sogar die Profis.
Also er hat sich sensationell geschlagen. Also immer im Hinterkopf behalten, das war sein erstes Mal und dafür war es wirklich grandios. Also allein diese professionelle Armhaltung, er ist überhaupt nicht nervös. Er kommt wie aus der Pistole geschossen, ist dabei lässig, ist dabei ruhig. Also besser kann man es nicht machen.
Zumindest bis zu diesem Moment.
The potential for a few flurries over Balmoral to the Hill Road District.
Und auch zum Schluss beweist der Prinz trotz fieser Vorhersagen Humor.
Thank God it isn't a bank holiday.
Na, wieso eigentlich? Bei so einem Auftritt im Wetterstudio geht doch immer die Sonne auf.
Good morning from the Johnson Space Center. This is Mission Control Houston. You're looking at the International Space Station Flight Control Room once again as a team of flight controllers watches over all of the systems aboard the International Space Station. The team today being led by Flight Director Ed Van Cise once again. He is watching over this team throughout much of the daytime hours. As his team is part of three teams that watch over the station systems around the clock. He's joined by Jay Marschke, who is handling a communications link, communications efforts between this team and the crew on board the International Space Station as well.
That's one of the reasons why it's good to have you guys look at
that crew on board the station is made up of three crew members. One of those, U.S. astronaut Don Pettit. He's serving as flight engineer number six as part of the Expedition 31 crew. He's currently working on an experiment that will take a good bit of the rest of his day. Efforts on that experiment ongoing real-time, the burning and suppression of solids experiment known as BASS. He's working directly with principal investigator Paul Ferkel, who is telerobotically taking part with him, looking over his shoulders as we are, as he operates this experiment. Ferkel has a PhD and is with the National Center for Space Exploration Research in Cleveland, Ohio. Along with Pettit, his other two crew members, Commander Oleg Kononenko, is operating in the Russian segment of the station. He's also spending some time doing some housekeeping chores in the U.S. segment, cleaning some filters as they periodically have to be checked to make sure that nothing is blocking the airflow or the flow to any of the other systems on board the station as well. Also on board is André Kuipers from the Netherlands. He is serving as flight engineer number five of the International Space Station. He is continuing with his efforts on what's known as the Energy Experiment, sponsored by the European Space Agency. It essentially is an experiment designed to help measure long-term space effects on astronauts' energies in space. So he's taking different types of measurements associated with that experiment as an ongoing effort. And Pettit also is taking part in that experiment as well. Those three crew members have been on board the station now for 140 days. They've been in space for 142 days since their launch on their Soyuz spacecraft back in December of 2011. They will be joined in the next week or so by three new crew members that are preparing for launch to the International Space Station there at the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan in the center. Gennady Padalka, who serves as the Soyuz commander, but he's also going to be the Expedition 32 commander. He's joined on the left by Sergei Revin, a cosmonaut colleague, and on the right by U.S. astronaut Joe Acaba. Their Soyuz spacecraft will be integrated with its rocket on Saturday and rolled to the launch pad on Sunday ahead of its launch to the International Space Station scheduled for 10:01 p.m. Central, 11:01 at night Eastern Time on Monday. Following a two-day rendezvous, they expect to dock with the International Space Station on Wednesday, with that docking scheduled for May 16th, just before midnight Central Time, and just after midnight Eastern Time on May 17th.
Good afternoon. My name is Dwayne Brown with the Office of Communications, and welcome to NASA headquarters. Asteroids are a popular subject these days, and today we'll get up close and personal with the giant asteroid Vesta, courtesy of NASA's Dawn spacecraft. We'll have brief presentations and then open it up for questions. And you can follow us on the internet at www.nasa.gov/dawn. And something we're doing to be included in science press conferences is using the incredible reach and audience of social media. So join the conversation. Ask a question at #AskNASA. And of course, you can follow us on the other NASA social media sites that include Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and others. Before I introduce today's speakers, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. Jim Green, Director of NASA's Planetary Science Division, to give us some opening remarks. Dr. Green?
Thank you very much, Dwayne. It's indeed a pleasure to come and talk about some of the exciting science results that we'll hear about today. But I want to take you back 50 years before we start. And consider this. 50 years ago, we only understood the solar system by analyzing the light from the back of a telescope. So this is indeed our 50th anniversary of planetary science. NASA put in place a whole series of programs that allowed us to launch satellites in far reaches of our solar system, from Mercury all the way out to the outer reaches of our environment. And over those years, we've made some exciting discoveries. The Discovery program, which started 20 years ago and have launched now 11 missions, brings that excitement really to a focus. And today's mission, Dawn, really exemplifies the exciting principle investigator science that's accomplished through this program. We're really so delighted with the results, knowing that there's more to follow as Dawn begins another journey. But for now, let's get going, and let me turn it back over to Dwayne to introduce the speakers.
Thank you, Jim. Let's learn about Vesta. Let me introduce today's speakers, starting with Carol Raymond. Dawn, Deputy Principal Investigator, NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. Hap McSween, University of Tennessee in Knoxville. Vishnu Reddy, a Dawn Framing camera team member from the Max Planck Institute for Solar System Research in Germany and the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks. David O'Brien, Planetary Science Institute in Tucson, Arizona. Christina De Sanctis, a Dawn co-investigator and visible infrared mapping spectrometer team lead from the Italian National Institute for Astrophysics in Rome. And with that, I'll turn it over to Carol.
Thank you, Dwayne. We're all delighted to be here today to talk to you about Dawn's first results from Vesta. Dawn's mission at Vesta has been a spectacular success, and it's transformed Vesta from a fuzzy orb into a planetary body, which has exceeded our expectations in many ways that we'll be talking about today. Dawn's data provide the first comprehensive analysis of Vesta's global properties and provide a firm link between meteorites that have fallen to Earth and their parent body, Vesta. May I have the first graphic? Now, Vesta is a very special and unique object. It's the second most massive asteroid and one of the brightest asteroids in the main belt between Mars and Jupiter. Its enormous size relative to other asteroids that have been visited is shown in this montage. And as we'll describe today, VESTA exhibits many characteristics that define it more as a body that is transitional between asteroids and planets than being more like your garden variety asteroid. The collection of six papers that are being published in Science describe VESTA's colorful and diverse surface and the planetary processes that have shaped the body since its formation. In the second graphic, this montage emphasizes that VESTA's history appears to be more similar to rocky terrestrial planets Mars, Mercury, and the Earth's moon than to its larger sibling, the dwarf planet Ceres, which will be the second target of the Dawn mission. Dawn's data have enabled the history of VESTA to be defined. It formed within 2 million years after the first solids formed in the solar system. Before Ceres formed, before the terrestrial planets formed, and when the concentration of radioactive material was short decay times, generated enough heat inside VESTA to cause melting. We now know that VESTA is the only intact, layered planetary building block surviving from the very earliest days of the solar system. VESTA is also very special because there is a class of meteorites, the Howardite Eucrite Diogenites, that have been linked to VESTA by telescopic observations. So Dawn is unique because it's the first time that a spacecraft has been able to visit an object known to be the source of samples after those samples were identified. We've had pieces of VESTA under study in the laboratory for decades, but are now only getting out to know the parent body. And Hap and Christina are going to be talking more about that. In the next graphic, I show some of the results of our mission. Dawn measured VESTA's mass very accurately and mapped its topography and gravity in great precision and resolution. The topography is shown here at the top as a color-contoured 3D map, and it's illustrating that VESTA has a very rugged topography, and it also displays very steep slopes, much steeper than is seen on planetary bodies. And this has been a big factor in the types of morphologies that we see on the surface. The gravity field is shown color contoured at the bottom. Dawn's gravity and topography reveal the internal density structure of VESTA and have confirmed that VESTA has a concentration of mass at its center, proving that it is a differentiated body with an iron core, a silicate mantle, and a less dense basaltic crust, the same as Mercury and Mars, the Earth and the Moon. In my last graphic, this is a cutaway view of VESTA's internal structure, and assuming that the core is made of the same material as iron nickel meteorites, we can use the gravity data to derive the size of the core, which is at about 70 miles in radius, or about 40% of the radius of the body, or about 18% of the mass of the body. Dawn's evidence for the differentiated nature of the interior of VESTA confirms conjectural theories based on the HED meteorites, and therefore increases the value of those samples for studying the processes in the early solar system. VESTA is special because it survived the intense collisional environment of the main asteroid belt for billions of years, allowing us to interrogate a key witness to the events at the very beginning of the solar system. We believe VESTA is the only intact member of a family of similar bodies that have since perished. I'll turn it over to Hap to tell you more about the HED meteorite connection.
Thank you, Carol. The synergy of spacecraft exploration and samples that can be analyzed in the laboratory has markedly enhanced what we understand about the moon. VESTA is special because we already have its sample in the form of hundreds of meteorites. I'd like to talk a little bit about how Dawn confirms this connection between the asteroid and rocks that fell from the sky. Could I have my first slide? Making this connection is a recurrent theme of our new science papers. Next slide, please. The Howardite Eucrite Diogenite meteorites, that's a mouthful, we normally say HED meteorites, are seen here as viewed through a microscope. The HEDs are a complex assortment of rocks whose properties indicate that some of them erupted on the surface as lavas, some of them cooled and crystallized slowly at depth in a large parent body. Next slide, please. At 325 miles across, Vesta is certainly a large parent body. This false color map of dawn framing camera band ratios illustrates that Vesta's surface is compositionally heterogeneous, like the HED meteorites and unlike the small asteroids that we have previously visited by spacecraft. Another indication that a large body produced the HEDs is its protracted impact history. Next slide, please. Most of these meteorites are breccias, that is, rocks assembled from broken fragments, as you can see on the left. And that is most readily accomplished in a large gravity field. The squiggles on the right show that these breccias were created by impacts over a period of perhaps a billion years. And the repeated impacts are recorded by resetting of some radioactive isotope clocks in the meteorites that can be analyzed. Next, please. The ancient age of Vesta's surface is revealed by Dawn's new high-resolution images of heavily cratered terrains, as you can see in this image, especially in the northern part of the image. The radiometric ages of the HED meteorites record their crystallization from magmas 4.5 billion years ago, and the density of craters in the northern region is consistent with that age. The next slide will show you the spectrum of sunlight reflected from Vesta and recorded by Dawn's VIR instrument. That spectrum, shown in white, closely resembles the laboratory spectra of the various HEDs, especially the howardites, which are samples most likely to have resided on the surface of Vesta. More importantly, the mapped locations of VIR spectral types make perfect geologic sense. Next slide shows a map of Vesta's South Pole region, and it illustrates the depth of the 1 micron band, which is a proxy for the proportion of diogenite. The eucrites, which formed on the surface, are concentrated in terrains outside of this region, and the diogenites, which formed deep underground, are only exposed where they have been excavated in large craters like the Rhea Silvia Basin, which is shown here and which Dave will talk about a little later. Finally, Dawn's new measurements of Vesta's bulk density and gravity allow us to reconstruct models of its unseen interior. The next slide shows you Carroll's diagram that indicates that Vesta has a large iron heart with a radius of about 70 miles. A substantial core is predicted for the HED parent body because they are depleted in metallic elements. And models for the HED parent body that are based on the properties of the HED meteorites predict a core of about this size. So Dawn's observations have convince most of us, certainly me, that Vesta is the HED parent body. With this link more firmly established, we're now using measurements of the HEDs to complement Dawn's remote sensing data and to help us interpret it better. The takeaway message is that we are now unraveling the geologic history of Vesta in ways that would not be possible without samples. I'd like to pass it on to Vishnu, who will talk about Dawn's new color images.
Thank you, Hep. So color images obtained by the Dawn framing camera basically shows that Vesta is unlike any other object we've visited so far in the solar system. And there are a few points I would like you to take away from my presentation here today. The first thing is that on Vesta, we see a wide range of brightness variation. So we see areas that are as bright as snow and areas that are as dark as coal. The second point I would like to make is that we see no evidence for its original crust. All the volcanic features we expect to see from the HED meteorites, we don't see any evidence of it. And the reason we think is that most of Vesta's original primitive crust has been affected by impacts, and all the original material has been pulverized and mixed together. The third point I'd like to make is that we have identified different colored units within Vesta's surface at different topographic levels. And this is evidence for an internal structure, just like happened, Carol pointed out. And the most interesting part about this is that the lowest point of the South Pole Rio Selvia Basin also shows a concentration of these diogenite meteorites. These are the meteorites we think came from the lower crust or probably the upper mantle of Vesta. So there's a correlation between composition and topography. The other thing we also want to share is that we don't find any evidence for olivine so far in the resolution of the images we've looked at. The final point I would like to make is that while Vesta has a lot of similarities with the moon, you know, the next largest differentiated object that we have in the inner solar system, apart from Vesta, there's some key differences. On the moon, what we see is that we have a clear correlation between topography and albedo. Typically, the lunar highlands are brighter than the lunar mare. But in Vesta, we don't see this clear correlation. And part of it, the reason could be the way the impact processes have affected it. Since we don't see the original crust of Vesta, the impact processes have pulverized and mixed all these different units, and we don't see that. With that, I'd like to show a couple of videos to illustrate my ideas. Here you see a beautiful image that has been wrapped on the shape model of Vesta, and Dave created this video of it. What you see here are the famous snowman craters. The largest crater there is the Marcia crater, which is approximately 60 kilometers across. And these are framing camera filters that are in the infrared. These are the wavelengths which typically we human beings won't see. I would say the closest thing that could actually sense an image like this is a rattlesnake. So if we had a snake snuck aboard Dawn, you would probably see an image like this of Vesta. And this shows some important information. As you can see, there's topographic lows within the large Marcia crater that is bright compared to the topographic highs, which are darker. If you go to the next video, please. The next video shows something slightly different. Here, what we have are color ratio images. What we have taken is taken these different filters and we have ratioed them so we get more scientific information about the surface of Vesta. What you see here is a 34 kilometer diameter crater named Opia, and it has this bright red ejecta that is coming out of this crater. And we're not really sure what this red ejecta is at this point, but we probably think it's related either to the impactor that affected it or probably something that it was excavated from within Vesta itself. So we get some really cool, not only real cool images, but also we get some important scientific information from this. So most of the science we've done so far has been using HAMO data, which is approximately 60 kilometers per pixel. We right now have LAMO images, which are at 16 meters per pixel. So we're continuing to do really cool science, and we hope to have many more exciting results to come. So with that, I'll pass on to Dave O'Brien, my colleague here.
Okay. Thank you, Vishnu. So as noted previously, Vesta dates back to the beginning of the solar system. And given its location in the asteroid belt, it's been recording impacts from asteroids ever since that point, making it a very important object to study as we're trying to reconstruct the dynamical history and collisional history of the solar system. The first slide shows a global map of the surface of Vesta from the framing camera data, showing a wide range of craters of all kinds of degradation states, from very young, fresh craters to very old, degraded craters. We've cataloged close to 2,000 craters larger than 2.5 miles on the surface, and are using those to help unravel the surface history of Vesta. The larger craters are sometimes difficult to pick out from the images alone. The next slide will show the global topography map. In this map, blue is low elevation and red is high elevation. We can pick out a number of large depressions, seven of which are circled on this map. These are the seven most prominent impact basins. There may be others as well. Some of the other low areas are of uncertain origin. One thing to note here is in this image, and it's more clear in the next slide as well, the two largest impact basins are in the South Polar region. Next slide, please. This shows the Rhea Silvia Basin and the Venenia Impact Basin, about 300 and 250 miles across, respectively, which are in the South Polar region. One of the new results from Dawn is that we've been able to use our global crater catalogs that have been created to count the numbers of small craters on these impact basins and estimate an age of them. Rhea Silvia Basin has a surprisingly young age of about 1 billion years old. The Venenia Basin, which lies partially underneath the Rhea Silvia Basin, has an age of about 2 billion years old or possibly somewhat older. Since Rhea Silvia formed on top of it, it erased some of the craters on Venenia, so it's difficult to get an exact age. So 2 billion years is a lower limit for that one. The relatively young ages of both of these basins is in stark contrast to what we find on the Moon, where all of the old basins are at least 3.5 billion years old. This is telling us that the dynamical history in these two different parts of the solar system, and the collisional history experienced by the Moon and Vesta, is surprisingly different. This is telling us something about the dynamical history of the solar system, and it's a complex story that we're really only beginning to unravel. In the next slide, you'll see how the relatively young formation age of the Rhea Silvia Basin has influenced the surface and led to a strong north-south dichotomy on Vesta. This image shows a one-quarter of Vesta's surface, sort of a wedge cut out of it, all the way from south to north. In the bottom, you'll see in the southern hemisphere the Rhea Silvia rim. And towards the north, where it's dark, is where we don't currently have data because that part of Vesta is still in shadow. You'll notice that in the south, there's very sharp topography and relatively few craters. As you move towards the north, there's a lot more craters. It's a very densely cratered surface. And also the topography is smoother and more eroded. This is because the formation of Rhea Silvia underneath the crater itself and outside of the crater for hundreds of miles covered that area in ejected material, essentially resetting the surface. So most of what we see in the south is really only about a billion years old. As we go towards the north, that's the much more ancient terrain of Vesta. The following movie, or the movie that is showing now, shows a view going into the South Pole Basin. Again, red is high and blue is low here. This is based on the global topography models. You'll see that there's a relatively high area surrounding the crater, the reddish rim in most areas. Where there's a gap is actually where the Venenia Basin is overlapped by Rhea Silvia. You'll notice in the center a very pronounced central peak, and also an interesting spiral and grooved pattern on the floor of the Rhea Silvia Basin. The central mound was somewhat surprising at first because it's much larger in proportion to the crater size than impact crater central peaks that we see on the Moon, for example. The next slide shows a view from the rim of Rhea Silvia looking into the crater. Next slide, please. Thank you. Here you can see a prominent scarp or cliff off to the right of the image, part of the rim of Rhea Silvia. In the center is a central mound. The top is actually imaging data wrapped over the topography, and the bottom is just the color-coded topography. The central mound of Rhea Silvia is about one-third of the diameter of the crater itself. At first, this was very surprising because craters on the Moon and other large bodies don't really look like this. When we've looked at other smaller bodies in the solar system, like outer solar system satellites, we've found that they actually have a similar structure with a very dome-like, very large central peak. This appears to be a consequence of craters forming on a body where the crater is almost as large as the body itself. So the planetary curvature really starts to play a role in the shape of the crater. We've been able to use the global topography models to make estimates of what the volume of the Rhea Silvia Basin is. In the next slide, we show a similar figure again, and our estimate of about 250,000 cubic miles of material excavated from Rhea Silvia. A large part of this material will remain on the surface, as I noted previously, erasing many pre-existing craters in the south. But a large fraction of this as well is ejected into space. To put this into another perspective, 250,000 cubic miles is enough to fill the Grand Canyon about 1,000 times over. So this is a very large volume of material. The amount of material ejected into space from the Rhea Silvia impact is more than enough to explain the number of Vesta family asteroids that we see in space. These Vesta family asteroids are very important because they're essentially an intermediate link between the surface of Vesta and the HCD meteorites that we have here on Earth. Another interesting point about this is that independent estimates of the age of that Vesta family put it at about 1 billion years. So the fact that we're finding 1 billion-year age for Rhea Silvia, which coincides with this estimate of the age of the Vesta asteroid family, really kind of ties the whole dynamical story together. So not only is the Dawn mission telling us that Vesta is the HED parent body, it's also solidifying the dynamical link between surface of Vesta and the bodies that we have on Earth that we're studying as meteorites. So with that, I'd like to hand it off to Christina, who will talk more about the composition of Vesta in the Rhea Silvia Basin.
Thank you, Dave. So Dawn demonstrates that Vesta is a small differentiated planet, and we see very deep down into Vesta crust and possibly also down to its mantle. We clearly see different minerals on Vesta, and they are the same that we have in our hands as meteorites, eucrites, auradite, and diogenites. Their global distribution tells us that Vesta would have been a magma ocean early in its history, and this new finding gives us windows in the process that formed the earliest body of the solar system. And in the next slide, you will see how the distribution of these minerals tell us about the Vesta history. These false color images, has been taken with the visible infrared mapping spectrometer. We use only 3 colors of the more 800 channels of this imaging spectrometer. And you see that there is a clear dichotomy between the northern equatorial region, the southern bluish region. And in next slide, you see that these two regions correspond to different composition, and this composition tell us about the process that formed Vesta. For instance, the blue curve that corresponds to the South Polar region tell us that we have typical minerals like diogenites. And these minerals are made by rocks formed via magmatism. In the next slide, you see how these minerals are distributed on the Vesta surface. The violet means that we have more diogenite-like mineralogies, while the yellow means that we have more eucrite-like lithologies. And the imaging spectrometer data tell us that the region of Rhea Silvia Basin is richer in diogenites, that is a mineral formed in deep crust, while in the more equatorial region we have a prevalence of eucritic minerals. And so we think that overall the mineralogy north-south diversity indicates that deep crust was exposed by the Rhea Silvia impacts, and the region in the equatorial northern part of Vesta seems to retain the most ancient rich mineralogy, rich eucritic mineralogies. And in the next slide, you see how this large scale variation is also seen in a smaller scale. So this is a false color image made by Vir. And this, if you look at this variegated surface, you see that we have a lot of different morphology, and this different morphology corresponds to different colors. So if we look in the box, so in the next slide you will see a zoom on this box. So this is the Oppia crater, and these three images has been done in order to highlight different things. The first one is the brightness in the visible wavelengths, and you see that we have a bright region and darker region, while the central panel is made using different color combination and highlights the different rock type and the ejected material from the crater. So you see the ejecta on one side of the crater that is completely different with respect to the rest of the materials. And the last figure is done in order to see the variation in the pyroxene abundance. Pyroxene is really important because it tells us about the history of Vesta, the evolution of Vesta. So to conclude, next slide, please. The local scale variation, with the fact that we have also this global diversity on Vesta, tell us that the Vesta crust could be a complex mixture of diogenites and eucrites, but the occurrence of a greater proportion of diogenitic material in the South Polar region deeply excavated tell us that this this is a critical find and is broadly consistent with the possibility that Vesta was melted early in its solar system. And these new results allow additional insight in the process that formed the early solar system. And now we will go back to Carol that will give us some remarks.
So thank you. I hope conveyed how excited we are about this new data and its significance. And I just wanted to wrap up with a few key points. The first is that Vesta is an intact protoplanetary body that is transitional between asteroids and planets. That Vesta is the parent body of the HED meteorites, which allows us to interpret Dawn data in far greater depth than would otherwise be possible. That Vesta has displayed unexpectedly large brightness variations, and that the giant Rhea Silvia basin is significantly younger than large impact basins on the Moon. And this was also unexpected and provides fundamental constraints on models of the dynamics of the solar system. And that wraps up our remarks.
Okay, well, thank you all. Okay, now it's time for questions. And again, I want to welcome our social media audience. And if you have a question, bring them on in at #AskNASA. And the conversation will not stop here, ladies and gentlemen. The Twitter feed, and I will give that out at the end of the show. You can join the conversation and ask questions in the conversation with the scientists and the team. So stand by for that. But right now, we're going to open the phone lines, and then we're going to take some questions from our social media audience. And first up will be Mike Walls.
Oh, hi. This is Mike Walls from space.com. I guess this is for Carol. You mentioned Vesta is probably the last surviving member of a class of objects that used to exist in the solar system. I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about what happened to the rest of those objects and sort of where does Ceres fit into that picture?
Sure. We know that from the debris field that's left in the asteroid belt, indicating there were other bodies that were differentiated similar to Vesta. We know this because there are iron meteorites that look like the cores of these bodies, stony meteorites that look like the crusts of these bodies, and with compositions which are roughly similar. So we could infer. And based on that and just our ideas about how the early solar system formed, that there were many of these planetary embryos that were coalescing and forming the rocky planets and the cores of the gas giants. So but what's clear to us is that Vesta appears to be the only intact protoplanet that's left because the collisional environment was so intense that many of these were just blasted into small pieces, which is what most of the belt is. So as far as Ceres, Ceres is also, it's not an igneously differentiated body. It still has a lot of its water, and so it has had a significantly different evolution than Vesta and the other planetary embryos like Vesta, but it's likely that its large size was a big factor in the fact that it still exists today.
If I could add something too, Vesta is basically a leftover planetary building block. What's happened to a lot of the bodies that probably resembled Vesta in the early solar system is that they have already been incorporated later into planets, into the growth of planets. So this allows us to see farther back in time, which is of course the basis for the name Dawn of the mission. This is a mission in time as well as in space.
Our next question is from Ken Kramer. Spaceflight Magazine.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. Great results. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about evidence. Is there any evidence elsewhere in the solar system of this massive impact 1 billion years ago, and what consequence could that have been for the Earth? Thanks.
Okay, I think the impact on Vesta was probably not part of a solar system-wide phenomenon. I think it was just a sort of a single impact on Vesta that happened to occur at that time. Unlike, for example, the late heavy bombardment, which is a sort of a one of the models for the bombardment history of the moon and the inner solar system, where a lot of impacts occur, say, around 4 billion years to 3.5 billion years ago. So this wasn't necessarily part of that. I think it was just sort of a later stochastic impact that happened to occur at that time.
Okay.
In terms,
I'm sorry. Go ahead, David.
In terms of the effect on the Earth, it's hard to say because it would have launched a lot of meteorites into space that would eventually make their way to Earth. So there might have been an increased number of meteorites falling on Earth, but in terms of large impacts like extinction level impacts, I don't think the Vesta impact would have had any effect like that.
Okay, as I mentioned earlier, we are incorporating something new here in our science briefings, and that is bringing in the incredible reach and audience of social media. So I'm going to ask Carol to drive the bus here. We've got several questions coming in, and for our social media audience, forgive me if I botch some of the names. They have some colorful names here that they're coming from, but do my best, and Carol will divvy out the questions as you see fit. Welcome, social media audience. And the first one is from @RyeInSpace. What is the predicted mineralogy of Vesta now, and what are the regolith and dust depths?
Who wants to take that?
Christine? For the regolith, I think Dave for the mineralogy. So concerning the mineralogy, we have evidence of silicatic mineralogies, pyroxene, different kind of pyroxene that are especially magnesium iron rich pyroxene, while we do not have large evidence for other blocks of different kind of minerals. Concerning the regolith, I think that Dave can say something more.
Okay, I don't have a good global estimate off the top of my head. One number that I can give, though, is that in the region around the Rhea Silvia impact basin, we've estimated from the sizes of craters that have been erased by the formation of Rhea Silvia that the ejecta blanket over that region is maybe about 5 kilometers thick. That's about 3 miles thick. So that wouldn't necessarily be fine powdery regolith. A lot of it might be large blocks, but it would be sort of a lot of rubble and smaller material that would be thrown over that area.
Let me add something about the mineralogy. The HEDs tell us that another major mineral that should occur on the surface is feldspar, plagioclase feldspar, and we don't have an instrument that is capable of seeing that. So this is a place where the meteorites are providing additional information that will complement what we get from remote sensing. Another thing that we see, another mineral that we see in some of the HED meteorites is the mineral olivine. Its presence is important because if we actually excavate down into the mantle of this body, we expect to see a lot of olivine. We see small amounts of olivine in the HED meteorites, but our instruments have not yet allowed us to see olivine on the surface of Vesta, and we're looking hard for it, but we haven't found it yet.
Okay, again, a reminder, send your question in to #AskNASA. And again, the conversation doesn't stop there. Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and in particular, and I'll give you the Twitter feed now and again at the end of the program, follow the conversation @NASA_Dawn. @NASA_Dawn. Next question from our #AskNASA is from @LW_RDCP. What is the importance of today's discoveries for future investigation?
Well, I can offer my opinion. What we're seeing at VESTA is has really expanded the ideas about the diversity that we might encounter as we go out into the asteroid belt and start looking at the myriad pieces that might be providing us additional information about the early solar system. And, you know, Ceres is extremely interesting body that we're already going to and studying, and so that is going to be another piece of the puzzle. But there are many asteroids that have interesting surfaces from, as seen from telescopes. There are many relationships of the types of asteroids you encounter with distance from the sun, which is also telling us something fundamental about the gradients in the material and the types of processes like collisional processes that are occurring. So what we're learning from VESTA that's honing our knowledge of the dynamics and of the possibilities of what these surfaces might hold is going to help us to formulate strategies for how we can narrow down to the few bodies that we want to go explore in detail later. And I'll also mention, and others may want to chime in, that the telescopes are still extremely important for us because they right now are really our eyes on the solar system. We don't have the resources to send spacecraft out to many bodies, so they're going to still be the workhorses to really reveal more information about all of the bodies out there.
Yeah, I just want to add that we did a lot of observations of VESTA using the NASA Infrared Telescope facility prior to arrival. And one of the things is that, like Carol said, we cannot go to every asteroid out there. But if we have ground truth of confirmation of what we see from the Earth versus sending, you know, a big spacecraft out there, we can do similar things with other objects, you know. So there's about 1 million asteroids. We can study them from the Earth, and we can extrapolate. We can know the differences of what are the limitations of what we can do. So far, it's really exciting to see that a lot of our observations that we made with the IRTF have been confirmed by Dawn. So it's a really important discovery.
Another possible payoff, although it's arguable, is that eventually we'll have the ability to mine asteroids, that we will find valuable resources on them. There was an article in the USA Today about that. I think it's a tough sell, but there are people who are putting large amounts of money into this idea, and it will be interesting to see if this might have a payoff in the future. But certainly, missions like Dawn that characterize the materials in asteroids are obvious precursors before we send out spacecraft that are going to try to bring materials back for commercial purposes.
Okay, we're going to take a question from a reporter who sent in from at NASA, and then we're going to go to the phone lines again. I believe Ken Kramer has another question, but this question is directed to Dr. Jim Green from the BBC correspondent Jonathan Amos Sr. Jonathan Amos, the science correspondent at BBC. Dr. Green, just an extra 2 weeks at VESTA would enable the Dawn team to fully image the North Pole. Will you give it to them?
Well, of course, it is a new Dawn in that we have allowed that extension to occur. There was a critical analysis that went on that allowed us to make that decision very easy. And that is the fact that we can make it to Ceres, which is a major part of the mission. As you know, Ceres is sort of in the outer part of the asteroid belt. Dawn is in the inner part of the asteroid belt, and the dynamics are such that those things continually move apart. And with Dawn's ion engines that are running much better than predicted, that really enables us to stay at VESTA longer. So we're very excited about that because it will map that unknown region. Mm-hmm. That region now is very important to look at because now we know about the Rhea Silvia impact and how that might affect the northern hemisphere will now be revealed. So indeed, it was an easy decision to make because the spacecraft is far more capable than its baseline, And we're really excited about that next step for Dawn.
Thank you, Dr. Green. Okay, we're going to go back to the phone lines, and then we'll come back for a few more questions before we wrap up. And we're going to go back to Ken Kramer from Spaceflight Magazine. Ken?
Okay, thanks. Actually, one of my questions was about the extended mission, so but let me ask a little bit differently. I believe you've been given 40 days. Can you talk about what you'll be doing in the 40 days? And I would like to know specifically about the illumination of the North Pole. Excuse me. Will it be fully illuminated or partially illuminated? And my second question is, and you may have touched on this, I'm sorry, talk a little bit about any evidence for material that you've seen excavated from the deep interior, not the first few meters, but I'm talking about miles deep, maybe to the core. Do you see any evidence for that? Thank you.
Okay, I'm happy to answer the first question. As Jim already discussed, we did already extend the mission significantly, about 40 days, without any impact on the mission timeline. And that is allowing us to do mapping later than was previously planned. That's going to achieve illumination to about 85 degrees north latitude at the same resolution as we've been discussing today. There will be a small area at the very North Pole, which will only be imaged a little bit later when it becomes illuminated adequately at a lower resolution. But the expectation is, if everything goes as planned, there will not be any unilluminated areas of Vesta that are left behind.
And I will answer to the second part of the questions. We see deep in the crust of Vesta, and we see all the structure in the Rhea Silvia Basin, that is several miles across the crust, and we are looking to search for evidence of mantle material. I have to say that we concluded the low orbiting mapping phase a few days ago. These data are especially concerning the mapping spectrometer, are concentrated in the South Polar Basin, and we need to look at this data carefully because those data has the highest resolution, and because we expected to have some materials from the mantle, but in a limited quantity. This is what we saw in the meteorites. We need to have a larger resolution as possible. So I think that the only way to detect eventually this kind of mantle material is going into detailed analysis of this last acquired data.
Okay, I'd just like to add a quick point that even with the best resolution, one of the things Hap pointed out was that in the meteorites itself, the evidence for mantle material comes from this olivine. It is comparatively less when you look at it, even in the HED collection. So one of the reasons why we don't see olivine is the fact that there's probably very little of it exposed. The second factor is that even if it was exposed a billion years ago, we have subsequent impacts that mixed it up with the surface. Now you see this, the footprint size, the best resolution we can get even with the framing camera is about 16 meters a pixel. So this olivine footprint has to be substantially larger than what we can resolve to be able to clearly, distinctly see it. You know, if you have an image that's 1,000 pixels by 1,000 pixels across, trying to identify one single pixel, there might be a 16, 20 meter unit of olivine exposed on the surface. So it's a lot more challenging. So like Christina said, we need better resolution. But as far as your question goes, whether we see anything from beyond the mantle, the answer is no. So because that's why we still have the asteroid intact.
Okay, we're going to do a couple more. I want to, first of all, thank our social media. Your questions are coming in fast and furious. And I'm not going to get to all of them, but remember, the conversation doesn't stop here today. Follow the Twitter feed at NASA_Dawn. The science team members are ready to answer your questions. We're going to take a couple of more, but remember, follow us at NASA_Dawn. Send in your questions if I don't get a chance to ask them. This next question is for Dr. Green again. From at S Observer. Will NASA be looking at perhaps using Vesta as a target for possible human exploration?
That's a good question. The asteroid belt is well beyond the orbit of Mars. And of course, the administration and NASA is very excited about the plans for human exploration to leave low Earth orbit. And consideration of going to asteroids is really limited to more near Earth objects, things that are much closer than Vesta. In the long run, I would love to see humans trek out of the solar system well beyond Mars. And perhaps the observations from Vesta that we're making today will allow future generations to think of the importance that Vesta might play in that exploration. But that will be well into the future.
Thank you, sir. Okay, this next question is from at Sky and Telescope. So I'm going to need your help here, Carol, to drive the bus here. Given the confirmation of Vesta's connection to HEDS heads, do you expect to find meteorite analogs after seeing Ceres up close?
Boy, I wish. It would make the exploration of Ceres a lot easier if we thought we had pieces in hand that could help guide our interpretations and even help calibrate our instruments. We thought about it, but and there are some classes of meteorites that might be similar. The carbonaceous chondrites come to mind, but we don't have any reason to believe that any of the meteorites in our collections now actually derive from Ceres.
Yeah, I'd also like to add too that Vesta is in a unique position because we had this very large impact, multiple large impacts at the South Pole. When we look at the distribution of asteroids in the main belt, there's these Vesta asteroid family members that stretch from Vesta to several resonances, and these resonances are essentially dynamical pathways to Earth. We don't see a similar thing when we look at Ceres. There doesn't seem to be a dynamical family associated with it that's got that convenient escape route to bring things to Earth.
Okay, I'm gonna do two more here because these questions are fantastic. And again, thank you for joining us, social media audience, and we'll see you again. From at Jurbin1997, is the concentration of minerals extraordinary? New, extraordinary, surprising?
Yes. Yes, in some sense, it's absolutely extraordinary the fact that we are able to recognize mineralogical region well-defined. So I think that it's really surprising the fact that having Vesta so ancient, so with a lot of cratering event, a lot of resurfacing of the surface, we are still able to see concentration of minerals in particular places of Vesta. So I think that is really surprising, also because all the other asteroids that has been visited so far are more or less uniform. Also Lutetia, that we visited not long time ago, is a large asteroid because it's a 100 kilometers asteroid. And in any case, its surface is completely uniform. So Vesta is really, really a surprise.
Do you have anything to
add? No, I'm good.
Okay, last one is from at Gabriella Retat. I hope I got that right, Gabriella. If Vesta made the same start as Earth-like planets, why did it not develop into a planet?
Okay, so if they started in the same way, why did they not? Well, the part of it is given Vesta's location in the asteroid belt. The asteroid belt is very close to Jupiter, and Jupiter is a very powerful gravitational influence. So in the inner solar system where Earth, Venus, Mars, and Mercury formed, things weren't really stirred up that much so that they were able to accrete together and form the terrestrial planets. In the asteroid belt, Jupiter basically stirred things up so much that they weren't able to easily accrete with one another. The velocities in the asteroid belt were really high, and the higher the velocity is, the harder it is for things to merge together under their own gravity. So there were probably many things like Vesta that were around where the Earth is now that are now part of Earth.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to wrap it up here. And again, I apologize for not getting all of the questions from social media. But remember, the conversation doesn't end here. If you have any questions or any other observations and want to follow a conversation about these extraordinary results about Vesta from the NASA's Dawn spacecraft, follow the Twitter feed at NASA_Dawn. And of course, all of this information is available on www.nasa.gov/Dawn. And for our various social media sites, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, it's all there. Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard the information about Vesta up close and personal. We thank you for joining us. Science never sleeps.
Die schlimmsten Befürchtungen sind wahr geworden. Das in Indonesien verschollene russische Flugzeug ist abgestürzt. Rettungstrupps sichteten das Wrack vom Helikopter aus. Nun sind hunderte Helfer auf dem Weg zur Unglücksstelle. Die Maschine war gestern mit rund 50 Menschen an Bord zu einem Demonstrationsflug gestartet. Vermutlich hat niemand überlebt.
Gegen diesen Berg ist die Maschine geprallt und zerschellt. Noch sind die Suchtrupps vom Boden aus nicht an das Wrack herangekommen. Wir haben sofort ein Rettungsteam losgeschickt, um Opfer zu retten, falls es wirklich das Wrack des Sushoi Superjets ist. Auf einem Bruchstück des Wracks konnten wir aber das Logo der Fluggesellschaft erkennen. Dies ist ein Foto des Superjets, aufgenommen beim Start in Jakarta gestern Mittag. 21 Minuten später riss die Funkverbindung zu dem Flieger ab. Vor dem Verschwinden war das Flugzeug, hier Archivaufnahmen eines baugleichen Typs, nahe des Vulkans Salak bis auf 2000 Meter abgesackt. Das indonesische Militär erklärte, die Maschine sei quasi vom Himmel gefallen. Verzweiflung bei den Angehörigen der Passagiere. Den meisten ist bewusst, ein gutes Ende wird dieses Drama wohl nicht nehmen. Aber solange es noch keine Gewissheit gibt, bleibt ein Funke Hoffnung. Wir haben keine Ahnung, was passiert ist. Die Rettung von Überlebenden, falls es welche gibt, hat absolute Priorität. Ich hoffe, dass alles schnellstmöglich aufgeklärt werden kann. Der Sushoi Superjet 100, ein Prestigeobjekt, war gerade auf einem Demonstrationsflug. An Bord potenzielle Einkäufer von Fluggesellschaften und Journalisten. Es war das erste Passagierflugzeug, das in Russland nach dem Zerfall der Sowjetunion konstruiert wurde. Stolz waren die Russen darauf. Mit dieser Maschine wollten sie den Sprung auf den internationalen Markt schaffen. Jetzt ist es mit diesen ehrgeizigen Plänen höchstwahrscheinlich erst einmal vorbei.
Chef Peter, was sind Ihre neuesten Informationen zum Unglück?
Ja, die Informationen aus dem Krisenstab in Jakarta sind sehr widersprüchlich. Mal heißt es, die indonesischen Retter haben die Unglücksstelle erreicht, arbeiten bereits vor Ort und melden keine Überlebenden. Danach wird diese Nachricht dementiert. Die Retter werden erst in einigen Stunden die Unglücksstelle erreichen können. Die Anzahl der Opfer hat sich anscheinend verändert. Es haben sich noch drei Passagiere gefunden, die diese Maschine verpasst und so überlebt haben. Genau wie mein Bekannter Sergei Doler, der nicht mitgeflogen ist, weil er Fotos machen wollte von dem Superjet von außen. Er hat auch die letzten Fotos dieser Maschine gemacht, die Sie gesehen haben. Wie dem auch sei, eine schwere Niederlage ist es für Putins Lieblingsprojekt, egal was die Katastrophe verursacht hat, ein technischer Fehler oder ein Fehler des Piloten. Das war übrigens ein sehr erfahrener Pilot, 57 Jahre alt war Alexander Jablonzew.
Vielen Dank, Peter Leontjew, für diese jüngsten Informationen aus Moskau.
Der Superjet 100, der in diesem Gebäude hinter mir geboren wurde, wird in Russland sehr oft Superstaubsauger genannt. Denn bis jetzt sind über 7 Milliarden US-Dollar in dieses Projekt investiert worden. Die Maschine sollte den Industriezweig retten, hat aber diese Aufgabe nicht erfüllen können. Eine große Niederlage für Putins Lieblingsprojekt, egal was die Katastrophe verursacht hat, ein menschlicher oder ein technischer Fehler.
Den Absturz eines russischen Flugzeugs nahe der indonesischen Hauptstadt Jakarta hat offenbar keiner der Insassen überlebt. Bis zu 50 Menschen sollen an Bord gewesen sein. Rettungskräfte trafen am Morgen an der Unglücksstelle ein. Nach offiziellen Angaben rammte das Flugzeug bei voller Geschwindigkeit einen Vulkan. Es befand sich auf einem Demonstrationsflug für Kaufinteressenten und verschwand plötzlich vom Radarschirm. Kurz zuvor hatte der Pilot ohne ersichtlichen Grund darum gebeten, tiefer fliegen zu dürfen. Das olympische Feuer brennt wieder. Die Flamme wurde in einer traditionellen Zeremonie im griechischen Olympia entzündet. Nach der Übergabe an die Organisatoren der Sommerspiele wird das Feuer in gut einer Woche nach Großbritannien geflogen und dann in einem Fackellauf durch mehr als 1000 Städte und Gemeinden bis nach London getragen. Dort werden die Olympischen Spiele dann am 27. Juli eröffnet.
Es ist das Symbol für die Olympischen Spiele. Das olympische Feuer, es brennt. Unter strahlend blauem Himmel wurde es im heiligen Hain des antiken Olympia entzündet. Der Tradition entsprechend mit Hilfe eines Parabolspiegels und der Kraft der Sonnenstrahlen. Ein großer emotionaler Tag für viele Griechen, denn die Tradition des olympischen Feuers reicht bis in die Antike zurück. Bei den Olympischen Spielen zu Ehren des Göttervaters Zeus waren Waffen und Kampfhandlungen untersagt. Als Symbol für den Frieden brannte deshalb ein Feuer. Heutzutage wird die olympische Flamme von Griechenland aus in das jeweilige Austragungsland getragen. Erster Fackelläufer wird der griechische Schwimmer Spyros Giannotis sein, der die Flamme zunächst nach Athen bringt. Die Ehre, sie zu tragen, wird in diesem Jahr auch einem 10-jährigen Jungen aus Deutschland zuteil. Gabriel Inci aus Großostheim bei Aschaffenburg darf die Fackel einige hundert Meter tragen. Zu verdanken hat er das der Städtepartnerschaft zwischen Großostheim und Olympia.
This is Mission Control Houston. Just to recap activities of the week aboard the International Space Station, a team of flight controllers that has been led much of the week by Flight Director Ed Van Cise, watching over his team throughout the daytime hours of the International Space Station as the International Space Station circles the Earth every 92 minutes at an altitude of about 250 miles, supporting the Expedition 31 crew of Oleg Kononenko from Russia, Andrei Kuipers from the Netherlands, and U.S. astronaut Don Pettit as they complete their four-and-a-half-month stay aboard the International Space Station. It's been a busy week for the crew as they have been spread throughout the 32,000 cubic feet facility, conducting science investigations, preparing for the arrival of three new crew members and the first ever commercial cargo spacecraft and routine housekeeping chores. Earlier this week, the crew began packing items for their return to Earth aboard Space Exploration Technologies Dragon spacecraft. In and around the conduct of science investigations, that pre-pack of about 1,000 pounds of equipment was completed Thursday, and Dragon now sits atop a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida, awaiting launch scheduled for 3:55 in the morning Central Time, 4:55 Eastern, next Saturday, May 19th. The crew also conducted training exercise this week with Mission Control, demonstrating their ability to follow procedures and respond to scenarios associated with a sudden depressurization of the cabin atmosphere. The training is conducted periodically to ensure the crew and flight control teams are ready to respond in the event of a similar real issue aboard the station. Pettit and Kuipers had a unique opportunity earlier in the week also to discuss their mission with the World Wildlife Fund annual global conference that was taking place in Rotterdam, the Netherlands. The WWF is one of the world's leading conservation organizations, working with more than 100 countries. Midweek, the focus was on unloading of cargo delivered aboard the ESA automated transfer vehicle, Eduardo Amaldi. That transfer activity continues throughout the week. Thursday, Don Pettit performed a unique experiment testing the properties of flame on various types of products to help investigators determine the burning and extinguishing characteristics of a wide variety of samples. He continues that experiment at the end of the week, and they also conducted, along with his other colleagues, other experiments, including measuring changes in energy balance to help determine energy needs for astronauts over long-duration space flights, and also develop an equation for energy needs of crew members in the future. threaded throughout the week. The crew continued unloading the ATV and Russian Progress supply vehicles. The 47 Progress unloading was completed midweek, and the loading of unneeded items began ahead of its departure. The crew will spend the weekend for the most part off duty conducting routine housekeeping chores, including exercise and earth observation, and also talking with their families. They will, however, keep an eye on preparations for launch of their newest crew member's arrival next week. The Soyuz TMA-04M is set to launch Monday night at 10:01 Central, 11:01 p.m. Eastern Time, delivering Gennady Padalka, Sergey Revin, and Joe Acaba to the station next Wednesday. Their preparations and those of their rocket and spacecraft are going well, with integration scheduled Saturday and rocket roll to the launch pad on Sunday. So it's been a busy week for the Expedition 31 crew, with another exciting week ahead as well, with the launch of the Soyuz spacecraft, and then next Saturday the launch of the SpaceX Dragon cargo vehicle to the International Space Station. NASA TV will begin covering the Soyuz launch Monday night at 9 p.m. That will be some bonus coverage with our additional to our usual hour of coverage that occurs in the morning at the 10 a.m. Central, 11 a.m. Eastern Time.
SpaceX continues its preparations for the launch of Falcon 9 at Florida's Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. The Falcon 9 rocket will send aloft the unmanned Dragon spacecraft to the International Space Station, where it will be grappled remotely by the Expedition 31 crew. The SpaceX mission, now scheduled to launch on the morning of May 19th, will be the first commercial venture to the ISS. Administrator Charlie Bolden headed a delegation of senior NASA leadership that met with Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihiko Noda to discuss international cooperation in space. Presented by Bolden with a montage of mementos flown on STS-135, the final space shuttle mission, Prime Minister Noda said he wants to excite young people about careers exploring space, noting his envy of the five meeting attendees who'd actually done that.
Which is also telling us something fundamental.
The first global analysis by the Dawn spacecraft of Vesta has uncovered some interesting new findings about the giant asteroid.
We now know that Vesta is the only intact layered planetary building block surviving from the very earliest days of the solar system. Vesta exhibits many characteristics that define it more as a body that is transitional between asteroids and planets than being more like your garden variety asteroid. Vesta is special because it survived the intense collisional environment of the main asteroid belt for billions of years, allowing us to interrogate a key witness to the events at the very beginning of the solar system.
Dawn has also confirmed that a certain class of meteorites found here on Earth originally came from Vesta, making Dawn the first reverse sample return mission in space exploration history. NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory captured these photos of a powerfully active region of the Sun called 1476 that's more than 60,000 miles across. This so-called monster sunspot has released multiple large flares. Sunspots occur where the magnetic field lines emerge from the inside of the Sun to form expanding loops above its surface. They appear dark because temperatures are considerably lower than in surrounding areas. SDO is the first launch mission in NASA's Living with a Star program, designed to understand the causes of solar variability and its impacts on Earth. Researchers with the Mars Science Laboratory project at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory recently took science journalists on a two-day field trip and workshop to California's Mojave Desert.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Isn't it great?
The journalists were shown sedimentary rock exposures that, like those the Curiosity rover will study on Mars, reveal to scientists the history of their environment.
The hard part is how to extract the information from the rocks. So that's what everybody's learning to do here.
is how to make measurements. We measure the thickness of the beds. We measure their grain size. We look at their mineralogy as best as we can understand it. And we record all of this information. And then from that, it will eventually allow us to reconstruct what kind of environment was here.
Liftoff of the Atlas V with Curiosity, seeking clues to the planetary puzzle about life on Mars.
The MSL spacecraft carrying Curiosity was launched November 26, 2011, and is scheduled for an August landing on Mars at a site known as Gale Crater. A full-scale test version of NASA's Orion spacecraft has arrived at the Virginia Air and Space Center in Hampton, where it'll be on display through the summer. The 18,000-pound test vehicle built at the nearby Langley Research Center was used in the successful pad abort test of Orion's launch abort system in May 2010. NASA's first spacebound Orion capsule will undergo an uncrewed exploration flight test 1, planned for 2014. EFT-1 will see Orion travel farther into space than any human-rated spacecraft has gone in more than 40 years.
Recently, a team of scientists and volunteers from NASA Ames Research Center searched for debris left in the wake of a large meteor that plummeted into Northern California on April 22, 2012. To expedite their search, researchers enlisted the services of an airship called Eureka for an airborne survey of the debris field. During a 5-hour flight, they searched a 300-square-mile area. They used a sophisticated video camera system that is commonly used to cover sporting events. Researchers were also conducting ground surveys to look for fragments. Within days, a NASA team was able to find and identify a fragment as a type of meteorite known as carbonaceous chondrite.
It is a really special meteorite because this particular one contains the all the goodies that scientists are interested in, the amino acids, all the compounds that could have made life possible on our planet.
Because meteorite fragments will quickly degrade when exposed to the elements, the rush to find them as soon as possible began. One of the larger fragments was discovered in the DeHaas family pasture.
I'm glad you found it there. I'm glad it's a piece that's going to be valuable to science, and I'm looking forward to hearing some of the results from it.
Along with the DeHaas fragment, over 20 specimens have been recovered. Some of the largest are now undergoing tests in a lab at Ames Research Center. This discovery could provide clues as to what our planet may have been made from and how life could have begun on Earth.
About 50 followers of NASA's social media websites got an up-close-and-personal, behind-the-scenes look at NASA's Dryden Flight Research Center during a NASA social on May 4th. The social media visitors, along with several news media representatives, were briefed on what Dryden is and does by center management, project engineers, and technicians.
Well, we're responsible for that collision avoidance stewardship throughout aviation.
They also toured various facilities, viewed research and support aircraft, had their photos taken in the cockpit of a NASA FA-18, and were even regaled by a low-level flyover and a sonic boom that occurred during a scheduled research mission support flight. The NASA social attendees responded by posting hundreds of tweets and comments about their experience on their Twitter, Facebook, and Google Plus accounts.
3, 2, 1. We have booster ignition and liftoff of the space shuttle Atlantis, maintaining America's constant presence in space.
15 years ago, on May 15, 1997, space shuttle Atlantis launched from the Kennedy Space Center on STS-84. The mission was the 6th shuttle docking to the Russian Mir space station, exchanging astronaut Mike Foll for U.S. crew member Jerry Leninger, who'd spent 123 days there. Rounding out the Atlantis crew were Commander Charlie Precourt, a 2012 inductee into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame, pilot Eileen Collins, and mission specialists Carlos Noriega, Ed Lu, Jean-Francois Clairvoy of the European Space Agency, and Elena Kondakova of Russia.
Go from Andy to start.
And May 16th marks the 1-year anniversary of the launch of STS-134.
So
zero and liftoff for the final launch of Endeavour.
NASA's youngest shuttle lifted off from the Kennedy Space Center at 8:56 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time to the International Space Station, carrying with it the six-person crew of Commander Mark Kelly, Pilot Greg Johnson, and Mission Specialists Mike Fink, Drew Feustel, Greg Shamatoff, and Roberto Fattori of the European Space Agency. The 16-day mission delivered the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer, the Express Logistics Carrier 3, a high-pressure gas tank, and spare parts for other station hardware. STS-134 was the 36th and next-to-last shuttle mission to the International Space Station.
Fascinates me, and I want to first of all show you what we're talking about. We're talking about this area here in the border between Pakistan and China. It's part of the old ancient Silk Road. It's called the Karakoram Highway, and it's the highest paved road in the world. So imagine you're here in the Himalayas driving through. It's actually quite a bit of traffic that goes through as the commerce goes in between the two countries. The road itself is over 4,500 meters tall, and it's high, I should say, at its tallest points. And then, of course, you have the mountains that peak even higher than that. Imagine driving through there and during a blizzard, not a good idea. Let's go ahead and look at the pictures here. So this is the latest blizzard that they've had. They had to just reopen the highway a couple of days ago. It had been closed because of avalanches. Now they had to reopen it. You see the soldiers are kind of walking around. They're actually at this post either on the Chinese side or the Pakistani side to guide drivers in situations like that. It becomes extremely dangerous. It's one of the most dangerous roads in the world because, of course, it's so high, but they're trying to prevent people from being injured. And there you see some of the pictures. Of course, amazing to have to drive through situations like that. But anyway, I just wanted to share those pictures with you. I want to show you also that we're still getting some what comes out in the form of rain and thunderstorms here as we head into the lower elevations. As we head farther to the north, of course, that goes in the way of snow. But in some of these more populated areas, again, thunderstorms popping up. That's helping the temperature down somewhat for some of you. But in places like New Delhi, we're still dealing with some pretty intense heat. You got up to the mid-40s again today, and you can see that heat is stretching all through these areas, waiting for the monsoon rains to finally begin. I want to show you very quickly across eastern China, we're still dealing with some pretty intense heat. Hong Kong, 34, your high today against an average of 27. And look at Beijing, 30 against a high, an average high of 25. But we're starting to see a little bit across Europe. Take a look. We have a couple of weather systems that are moving through here. And the first shot, you can see it come in, whoosh, just kind of blowing through northern parts of Europe. We're starting to see this move now to the north central portions of the continent, but still pretty unsettled here across the north and west. Enjoying pretty nice weather across the western Med here. Could use the rain. Looking at some rain showers also back over here to Turkey. And look at the possibility of some strong storms moving not just in the east, but also here across the north and west, including the possibility of hail, maybe some strong winds embedded within those thunderstorms, and not ruling out the possibility of some isolated tornadoes. Look at Paris. You shot up your temperature almost 30 degrees right now, 28. It's downright hot there for Paris, and 25 in Berlin. London staying cool. It's on the cloudy side. Rain moving in later. It's 15 degrees right now. Back to you.
War richtig warm in ganz Deutschland, doch die Freude hielt nur kurz, denn nach der Hitze kommt jetzt der Temperatursturz. Und der soll laut Meteorologen neben heftigen Gewittern sogar vereinzelt Tornados verursachen. Damit aber nicht genug. Die Eisheiligen sind da und bringen Frost im Mai. Kurt Eickhoff über eine ungemütliche Großwetterlage.
Morgens 9:30 war die Welt noch in Ordnung. Im Norden beim Hamburger Hafengeburtstag, wie auch im Süden im warmen München. Eine Erfrischung jederzeit willkommen. Nachmittags gab es die dann eher unfreiwillig, nachdem kalte Polarluft aus dem Norden kam, wie hier in Wernigerode in der Mitte Deutschlands, wo Frauchen kaum noch den Hund vor die Tür jagen mochte.
Über Deutschland haben wir derzeit eine sehr extreme Wetterlage mit großen Temperaturgegensätzen. Nördlich von Hamburg nur 15 Grad, im Süden verbreitet Werte um die 30 Grad. Und dort, wo diese beiden Luftmassen aufeinandertreffen, bildet sich jetzt eine Zone aus mit kräftigen Gewittern, örtlich mit Hagel, Platzregen, Sturmböen und auch einem kleinen Tornadorisiko.
Ein Vorgeschmack davon, gestern Abend schon in Nordrhein-Westfalen, vereinzelt bildeten sich Windhosen wie hier in Duisburg. In Goch am Niederrhein wurde fast das gesamte Dach dieses Neubaus vom dritten Stock auf die Straße geschleudert.
Es hat einen großen Knall gegeben, bin rausgerannt und dann habe ich schon gesehen, wie so ein Wirbelsturm das Dach runterfloh.
Morgen gibt es einen Temperatursturz in ganz Deutschland, örtlich sogar Bodenfrost. Diesen Kaltlufteinbruch Mitte Mai bezeichnen Wetterexperten seit Jahrhunderten als Eisheilige, heute kaum noch bekannt.
Eisheilige, nein. Obwohl, ich glaube, das hat was mit dem Wetter zu tun. Ja, dann kommen doch diese Blumen von unten.
Vielleicht hat man das irgendwie so statistisch gesehen, dass es in der Zeit wohl immer sehr kalt war.
Die Eisheiligen sind die Namenstage von Pankratius, Servatius und Bonifatius am 12., 13. und 14. Mai. In den vergangenen Jahren blieb es aber so warm, dass die Rede eher von Schweißheiligen war.
Tja.
Pieces of the Sukhoi Superjet 100 strewn across this mountain. You can see how the Russian-made plane was virtually ripped apart on impact. These are pictures that rescue workers filmed once they finally made it to the site of the wreckage. It's been a challenging rescue operation. They've had to use climbing equipment and ropes to get here. Inside these body bags, the remains of the passengers on the Russian-made plane. Officials say many of the bodies were torn apart by the impact of the crash. They're being brought to hospitals in Jakarta, where they will be examined for identification. But it will be difficult.
There are several bags that contained body parts from different passengers. Police and the National Search and Rescue Agency are working their best to identify the victims.
This is an immense tragedy for Indonesia. Most of the people on board were Indonesian. It's still not absolutely clear who was on the plane, though. Officials say because this was a demonstration flight, passengers were allowed to hop on and off. Didit has been waiting anxiously for any information about his wife, who's thought to have been on the plane.
My wife was on board. My gut feeling says her body is inside the bag, but I will wait for the official announcement.
This is thought to be the Sukhoi Superjet 100 taking off on Wednesday. The ill-fated flight was supposed to be in the air for just 30 minutes, a quick joyride to show off the plane to potential buyers and journalists. It never made it back. Rescuers are now looking for the black box, which should reveal what caused a brand new plane to vanish off the radar screens and crash into the side of a mountain. Karishma Vaswani, BBC News, Jakarta.
A well-publicized U-turn this week on the type of Joint Strike Fighter jets it's ordering for the UK's aircraft carriers. But it'll still be several years before either the new planes or ships come into service. In the meantime, the Royal Navy is sending its pilots to the US for training. Caroline Wyatt reports.
Lieutenant Dan Latham is one of the lucky few chosen by the Royal Navy to train on US fighter jets. Just 28 years old, he's one of the aircraft carrier pilots of the future, for a time when the UK once again has a carrier with aircraft to fly from it.
Sir, Lemoore Tower, runway 32 right, Bravo intersection, wind calm, cliff takeoff, departure.
The British pilots here work closely with their US colleagues from Naval Air Station Lemoore, flying training missions on F-18s over the California desert before they learned to fly from one of America's 11 aircraft carriers.
Took a lot of acclimatization. It's a very different flying environment to say flying out of the north of Scotland when it's, just above freezing. So that took some getting used to. Also, small things you wouldn't think were that important, but sometimes the accent will catch you out over the radio and the air traffic controllers. That can sometimes be a battle. Sometimes it did feel very much like a foreign language. But you overcome those, and with a little help from your colleagues in the US Navy and your fellow students and your fellow pilots, they help you get you through.
The ready room is where the pilots meet to prepare ahead of their mission, with the British pilots accepted as part of the team here.
We all enjoy having a good time. We all have really big egos, and we really all enjoy doing what we like doing. So that kind of combined camaraderie of having them join in our ready room here has added to the atmosphere, and really bringing their experiences from the UK into here and sharing with us.
The American and British military have operated side by side in both Iraq and Afghanistan, and one British pilot here recently flew missions over Afghanistan from a US carrier.
Some 9 Royal Navy pilots are currently in the US, the majority of them flying F-18s, with another 4 pilots still to come. The aim is to keep up the Royal Navy's maritime flying skills, as until the British aircraft carriers are delivered, and to ensure a smooth transition to the Joint Strike Fighter aircraft. The UK's carriers are still a decade or so away, while the costs of the Joint Strike Fighter are escalating by the month. But Lieutenant Dan Latham hopes he'll be one of those flying the new stealth plane, and ensuring the skills needed to fly from a British carrier aren't lost in the intervening years. Farron White, BBC News, in California.
Надо думать. Надо. Знаете что, Леха? Я ухожу туда.
Well, it's an amazing day, first of all. I mean, I think the last time we were out here, it was a little bit cooler day, and beautiful day to put a rocket up in the vertical. The process went very smoothly, and we're ready to go. But it's really an exciting time. It's really what makes the International Space Station. You know, we have vehicles from multiple countries coming up. We have, as you just said, commercial space is just getting ready to get started, bringing equipment up, so we're excited about this time.
These guys are ready to go. They've been trained, and the fact that the date shifted a little bit, it's not a big deal. They're very professional. Gennady, of course, his third trip up to ISS, and Joe's, this will be his second trip up, and Sergei's his first trip. So a very experienced crew. They're going to do great, and they're very flexible. They're ready to deal with the change that might come their way. It's a huge space station. There's always some little thing that we're working on, but it's in great shape. The crew's been doing great in far as utilization. This last increment was the first time we'd averaged over 35 hours a week during that increment, and we're expecting to do at least that much with this increment. So lots of research going on. They have over 287 different investigations they'll be doing, and over 400 principal investigators who will be involved in all the experiments they're going to be doing. Lots of reviews for the upcoming traffic, as we talked about, SpaceX and HTV, and of course we have a 47 Progress is going to go away and come back to the ISS, and then we have 48 Progress, so lots of vehicles coming and going, but it's a very busy time, but these guys will still be doing great utilization.
Good morning, this is Mission Control Houston. Welcome and thank you for joining us for today's edition of ISS Update this Monday, May 14. Aboard the orbiting complex, station commander cosmonaut Oleg Kononenko and flight engineers European Space Agency astronaut Andre Kuipers and NASA astronaut Don Pettit begin their third week as the Expedition 31 crew and their 21st week in space. Meanwhile, back on Earth, cosmonauts Gennady Padalka and Sergey Revin and NASA astronaut Joe Akaber are now in their sleep period in Baikonur, Kazakhstan, from where they will launch aboard their Soyuz 04M to the International Space Station in a little less than 12 hours. Final countdown of tonight's launch from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan will begin at 2 p.m. Central Time. Live coverage of the launch will begin here on NASA television at 9 p.m. Central Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time. That'll be followed by the liftoff at 10:01 p.m. Central Time. The trio will join the crew aboard the orbiting complex on Wednesday when their Soyuz spacecraft docks to the Poisk module after their two-day voyage to the station. Live coverage of the Soyuz launch, docking, and hatch opening will be aired here on NASA television. Again, that launch coverage will begin tonight at 9 p.m. Central Time. Today, Station Commander Oleg Kononenko is busy with some maintenance work to pump wastewater to a water tank aboard Progress for its eventual disposal, while flight engineers Andre Kuipers and Don Pettit work together to perform the closeout of a replacement of one of the station's attitude control systems, GPS. The repair work is to recover communication connection of the failed GPS that was discovered late last week. The replacement is necessary to accommodate the upcoming rendezvous and docking of SpaceX's Dragon commercial spacecraft that is scheduled to launch at the end of this week on May 19. Earlier this morning, Commander Kononenko spent some time monitoring a Russian study known as Matryoshka that looks at radiation exposure of long-term spaceflight. He also spent some time this morning collecting air samples for analysis, performed some maintenance to the Russian life support system known as SOJ, and also conducted the quarterly maintenance to the onboard treadmill exercise equipment. Flight engineers Don Pettit had spent his morning working to reestablish communication connection with the failed GPS and also troubleshoot with the ground controllers before setting up to remove and replace it with an onboard spare. He and Andre Kuipers also spent some time this morning collecting biological samples in participation of the energy experiment. That experiment measures the changes in energy balance during long-term spaceflight.
Es ist kurz nach 18.45 Uhr, hier sind die Nachrichten bei RTL und das sind unsere Themen, Aufwind für Rot-Grün. Sie haben es gerade schon gesehen, der deutliche Wahlsieg setzt Kanzlerin Merkel unter Druck. Und Rätselraten um Boxenexplosion. 31 Menschen werden nach dem Formel-1-Rennen von Barcelona in der Garage des Williams-Teams verletzt. Experten prüfen nun, wie es zu der Verpuffung kommen konnte. Guten Abend, herzlich willkommen bei RTL Aktuell, Sport bei uns in der Sendung, auch heute mit Ulrike von der Gröben.
Guten Abend.
Die Siegerin der Landtagswahl in Nordrhein-Westfalen, Ministerpräsidentin Hannelore Kraft, wurde heute nicht nur in der Berliner SPD-Parteizentrale mit Glückwünschen überhäuft, selbst die Bundeskanzlerin und CDU-Chefin Angela Merkel gratulierte. Der unterlegene CDU-Kandidat Norbert Röttgen musste sich dagegen heftige Kritik aus den eigenen Reihen anhören. Alexander Oetker hat in Berlin die Gewinner und die Verlierer der NRW-Wahl beobachtet.
Heute will jeder mal. Hannelore Kraft keck gepunktet ist am Morgen Ziel herzlichster bis heftigster Umarmungen und muss sogar als Fotomodell herhalten. Der Parteivorsitzende knipst persönlich und dann gibt's rote Blumen nach fast schlafloser Nacht.
Ich habe heute Morgen, als ich wach wurde, habe ich mich erstmal einmal gezückt und habe dann gleich noch mal auf die Zeitung geguckt, das vorläufige amtliche Endergebnis und habe gesagt, ja, es ist wahr und es war ein tolles Gefühl heute Morgen.
Das Ergebnis zum tollen Gefühl, die CDU im freien Fall bei 26,3%, Krafts SPD bei 39,1%, die Grünen stabil bei 11,3%, die FDP bei 8,6%, die Linke raus und die Piraten drin mit 7,8%. Er musste heute ganz stark sein, der Blickkontakt zur Chefin fiel mager aus. Blumen gab es aber trotzdem für Norbert Röttgen doch fast verschämt, packte er die zur Seite. Offiziell aber nahm die Kanzlerin ihren gefallenen Hoffnungsträger in Schutz.
Ich habe gesagt, wir verlieren gemeinsam, wir gewinnen gemeinsam. Traurig sind wir alle.
Traurig, weil Röttgens gewöhnungsbedürftiger Wahlkampfstil dazu führte, dass 110.000 CDU-Wähler, die vor 2 Jahren noch der Union ihre Stimme gegeben hatten, gleich ganz aufs Wählen verzichteten. 270.000 wechselten zur SPD, 60.000 zu den Piraten und 190.000 zur FDP. Christian Lindners Brust am Tag danach stolz geschwellt, doch der angeschlagene Philipp Rösler macht Lindners Sieg zu seinem.
Das zeigt, die Menschen wollen eine Partei der Mitte. Sie wollen eine liberale Stimme in den Landtagen, in den Parlamenten.
Heimlich, still und leise verabschiedet sich die Linke schon wieder aus einem Landesparlament. Um den Trend zu stoppen, will Oskar Lafontaine jetzt erneut Bundesvorsitzender werden. Die SPD dagegen derzeit im Aufwind. Wäre es nicht so plump, könnte man sagen, die Roten haben Kraft getankt.
Tja, so viel Rückenwind bei der Opposition, das dürfte der Kanzler die kommenden politischen Entscheidungen erschweren. Über Angela Merkels Tag danach und wie der Wahlausgang in Nordrhein-Westfalen die Politik in ganz Deutschland beeinflusst. Dazu mehr von Cordula Robeck.
Beim Kasatschok pfeift Angela Merkel mit. Wenigstens beim Schulbesuch heute in Berlin-Charlottenburg konnte die Kanzlerin mal den Wahlärger vergessen. Doch seit Norbert Röttgens Wahlniederlage in NRW schwinden in der großen Politik Merkels Machtoptionen genauso wie die Wähler. 1000 CDU-Anhänger geben schon jeden Monat ihr Parteibuch zurück.
Die Gruppe der Stammwähler wird sehr viel kleiner, die Gruppe, um die man werben muss und die sich von Fall zu Fall auch im Blick auf bestimmte Situationen entscheiden, wird größer.
So urteilen die Wähler nicht mehr nur über Parteien, sondern über das Gelingen einzelner Vorhaben, Beispiel Energiewende und wie Strom bezahlbar bleibt. Da machte Umweltminister Röttgen schon bisher keine gute Figur. Jetzt wird offen gezweifelt, ob er der richtige Mann für diese Aufgabe ist.
Mich interessiert die Energiewende und die hat viele Baustellen und die müssen jetzt gelöst werden. So können wir auch in der Energiewende nicht weitermachen.
Und aus Röttgens Wahlschlappe in NRW musste Merkel lernen, allein mit Sparappellen, um Haushalte zu sanieren, gewinnt man keine Wähler. Auch viele europäische Partner, wie der neue französische Präsident, setzen stattdessen auf Wachstum, genau wie die Opposition zu Hause, die lieber Geld ausgeben will gegen die Krise. Und so schwenkt auch Merkel langsam um. Gleichzeitig gewinnt der liberale Koalitionspartner wieder an Selbstbewusstsein, lag bei den Wahlen in 2 Ländern deutlich über 5%. Und an eine schwächelnde Union will man sich da nicht sklavisch binden.
Aber gleichwohl muss für die FDP auch gelten, dass wir uns für den Fall, dass Konstellationen, die wir uns wünschen, nicht möglich sind, jedenfalls die Problemlösungsmöglichkeiten erhalten.
Heißt, zumindest Kubicki und Lindner wären wohl auch zu Ampelbündnissen mit SPD und Grünen bereit. Noch ist die SPD von ihrem Erfolg in NRW erstmal berauscht und nicht auf der Suche nach neuen Partnern. Mit Blick auf die Bundestagswahl 2013 aber könnte sich das schnell ändern und Merkel weiter in Bedrängnis bringen.
Frage dazu noch an unseren politischen Chefkorrespondenten Lothar Keller in Berlin. Lothar, viele sehen in dem Wahlergebnis ja ein Signal für die Bundestagswahl im kommenden Jahr. Macht sich die SPD jetzt zu Recht Hoffnungen auf Rot-Grün auch im Bund?
Also die SPD hatte gestern die deutlich beliebtere, stärkere Kandidatin. Das Problem der SPD ist, im Bund sucht sie nach sowas noch. Gabriel Steinmeier, Steinbrück, die versprechen alle nicht den ganz großen Schub. Und dann Lore Kraft hat ja schon gesagt, als Kanzlerkandidatin stehe sie nicht zur Verfügung. Also SPD und Grüne jubeln heute zu Recht, aber über ihre Chancen für die Bundestagswahl gegen eine beliebte Kanzlerin sagt das noch nicht so viel.
Gilt das auch für die FDP? Wie steht es jetzt im Parteichef Philipp Rösler?
Also wenn die FDP bis Jahresende nicht deutlich über 5% im Bund kommt, wird das wohl das Aus sein für Rösler. Dann wird die FDP hoffen, mit Christian Lindner als Parteichef oder Spitzenkandidat vor allem, sich neu aufzustellen, durchaus auch unabhängiger von CDU und CSU, sodass eine Ampelkoalition mit SPD und Grünen dann auch möglich würde für die FDP.
Was aber dann logischerweise auch für die Kanzlerin gefährlich würde. Wie müsste sie damit umgehen?
Also leichter wird das Regieren für sie natürlich nicht, aber das Debakel von gestern bleibt erstmal an Röttgen hängen, nicht an ihr. Sie gehört weiter zu den beliebtesten Politikern in Deutschland. Nächstes Jahr muss sie diese Beliebtheit dann in Stimmen für ihre Partei umwandeln, denn nur wenn die Union deutlich stärkste Kraft wird, hat sie eine Chance weiter zu regieren, in welcher Koalition auch immer. Und eines hat Merkel schon längst verstanden, allein mit Spardrohungen gewinnt man keine Wahl. Man muss den Bürgern auch was bieten, man muss zeigen, dass man sich kümmert. Modell Landesmutter eben, so ein bisschen wie Hannelore Kraft.
Schönen Dank für diese Einschätzung. Lothar Keller live aus Berlin. Touristen an Bord ist heute Morgen im Himalaya-Gebirge in Nepal abgestürzt. Beide Piloten sowie 13 Pilger aus Indien starben. 6 Insassen überlebten das Unglück. Rettungskräfte brachten die Verletzten ins Krankenhaus. Unter ihnen sind ein Paar aus Dänemark und ein kleiner Junge aus Indien. Die Propellermaschine war kurz nach dem Start vom Flughafen Jomsom wegen technischer Probleme umgekehrt und dann an einem Berg zerschellt.
You know, this is a very remote area. It's very difficult to find information. We couldn't even find weather observations for this particular location. We found them for Kathmandu, of course, the bigger airport. But for many tourists, for many people, the way to get around is through these small airlines that go from place to place. Of course, the terrain is one of the main things. I want to show you something, first of all, right over here on the satellite image. This is Johnson. This is near where that plane crash actually occurred. And it's such difficult terrain to maneuver anyway. As far as weather, if you look at this, you really can't see much, right? But then you see these clouds that form later in the day. When this happens, the wind does get pretty strong. We didn't see any big storms nearby. But let me go ahead and show you here on Google Earth. This is the Johnson Airport. It's always usually listed as one of the more dangerous places in the world, one of the most dangerous airports, and this is why. It's in the mountains. You can see it right over here in one of these valleys. It's already at an altitude of about 2,600 meters, and any pilot trying to land here, trying to maneuver around here, would have to negotiate all of these mountain ranges. The plane was on its way from Johnson all the way to Pakora. This flight is expected to take maybe 25 to 30 minutes at a time, but it has to go through this very scenic route and sometimes a very dangerous route. As I understand it, this plane crash happened around 10 a.m. local time. That's about the cutoff of when planes take off and land from the Johnson Airport, because the winds tend to pick up in the afternoon. So you have all of these factors playing in. Sometimes you that make it a dangerous place, airport. You have strong winds, you have the difficult terrain, you have changes in weather that happen very quickly, and all of these things combined can sometimes be a factor. Was it a factor in this case? It's much too early to tell, and of course, that investigation is still underway. As we understand it, the pilot said that he was returning to the Pokhara Airport from Johnson, and they did not make it. They crashed right outside of the Johnson area. So perhaps the winds were too strong. Maybe they had some problems. Too early to tell. So there's the cloud cover. We did get some strong thunderstorms popping up here across other parts of to the south here for India. Still waiting for the monsoon. Temperatures are scorching hot still. Let's go ahead, how your weather's going to turn out.
Wir sind beim Sport, bei der Formel 1, und wir müssen das nochmal angucken, was da gestern passiert ist.
Ja, da muss man so einiges angucken, denn die Formel 1 spielt völlig verrückt. In jedem Rennen hüpft ein anderer auf Siegerpodest. Fahrer, Fachleute und Fans sind gleichermaßen ratlos. Ein Außenseiter rast allen davon. Der Rekordweltmeister wird mehr und mehr zum Crashpiloten. Und beim Siegerteam bricht dann auch noch Feier aus. Reinhard Brinks versucht, das Durcheinander von Barcelona für Sie zu ordnen.
Ein brasilianischer Reporter berichtete gerade vor der Williams-Box, als plötzlich die Flammen loderten. Mitarbeiter brachten den im Rollstuhl sitzenden Teamchef Frank Williams in Windeseile in Sicherheit. 31 Personen wurden verletzt, 7 von ihnen wurden wegen Verbrennungen und Rauchvergiftungen ins Krankenhaus geflogen. Eine Verpuffung in der Tankanlage hatte das Feuer wohl ausgelöst. Das Unglück überschattete leider die Sensationsleistung von Pastor Maldonado. Der 27-Jährige hielt im Williams bei seinem ersten Sieg fast 30 Runden Fernando Alonso in Schach. Bei Experten war der Mann aus Venezuela bisher eher für seinen verwegenen Fahrstil bekannt.
Das ist schon ein wilder Hund, der manchmal Sachen macht, wo die Ingenieure hinterher den Aufschrieb anschauen und sich wundern, wie er das hingekriegt hat, dass er nicht dabei rausgeflogen ist.
Raus flog aber mal wieder Michael Schumacher. Im 5. Rennen kam er zum 3. Mal nicht ins Ziel. Bei der Kollision mit Bruno Senna gab er dem Brasilianer die Schuld und bezeichnete ihn über Bordfunk wenig freundlich. Die Rennkommissare machten aber Schumacher als Unfallverursacher aus. Der Silberpfeilpilot wird beim nächsten Rennen 5 Startplätze nach hinten versetzt. Eine Bestrafung, die für Experten in Ordnung ist.
Die Schuld liegt bei Michael Schumacher, denn der ist ja mit einem irrsinnigen Überschuss in den Senna hineingefahren. Und das zeigt mir, dass sich der Schumacher vertan hat, nicht der Senna.
Die deutsche Ehre in Barcelona rettete Sebastian Vettel, der trotz einer Durchfahrtsstrafe nach toller Aufholjagd am Ende noch auf Platz 6 raste und so seine Führung in der WM-Wertung mit 61 Punkten behauptete. Nach Punkten gleichgezogen hat nun aber bereits Alonso. Auf Platz 9 zu finden der Barcelona-Sieger Pastor Maldonado, der den Schock des Feuers noch verdauen muss. Obwohl Computer, Ersatz und Ausrüstungsteile im Wert von 3 Millionen Euro zerstört wurden, ist der Start des Williams-Teams in 2 Wochen in Monaco nicht gefährdet.